You really are a heel. You're as cuddly as a cactus. You're as charming as an eel.
Mr. Nigger, nigger, nigger.
You're a bad banana with a greasy black peel.
Black, destitute of light, devoid of color, enveloped in darkness, hence utterly dismal.
You're a monster.
Mr. Nigger, 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 nigger.
A privileged black male, young academic in the New England area. Hope you're warm, sir. Yes, sir. Good to hear from you.
I'm an invisible man, like others before me. I'm learning that I owe my invisibility not to some biochemical accident or some supernatural cause, but rather to the unwillingness of others to notice me because I am black and I am male and I feel oppressed by my sex. From experience, I'm learning that my invisibility can serve as an advantage and a constant aggravation. I'm learning the effects of racism on the victim and the perpetrator. Educational scholars, policymakers, and teachers' preparation programs may convince the populace that they want more black male teachers, but this is an open contradiction that one would assume to be colorblind and defend whiteness indirectly, while simultaneously creating boundaries and perpetuating racial and ethnic segregation in the urban inner city school system. I have been attempting to teach for 8 years, and I have been angry for some time now. I sit with my thoughts, and my anger grows in intensity. It grows in intervals. This anger may seem to subside, but it remains there haunting me. Yes, I am angry, and I believe my anger is trying to communicate that I don't like this. Stop. What I have experienced is not just. I don't want to be treated this way. Most of all, I have become angry with myself because of my submission. I do not doubt that I was set up to fail because those that classify themselves as white possess the power that I lack. And even if I follow all of their rules, whites still possess the overwhelming power to alter my life. I have learned this from experience, not because it is constantly televised. I know this because I should be a certified educator now, and I'm not. My anger is my form of grief. Rather than just being destructive, I have decided to use my anger to foster a greater connection to my environment. The idea struck me as I watched four black high school teenage boys strike another black boy to the ground, hitting him on the back of the head while he wasn't looking and proceeding to stomp in his skull. They were angry naturally and decided to use fighting as a coping mechanism, otherwise normal behavior. Get that dirty motherfucker. This is what he deserves. I stood there in shock because there was nothing I could do. Teachers began to close their doors as I shouted out for security, which took 5 minutes to arrive. I had two options. I could watch these boys skull stomp in the hallway outside of my classroom or behave like my colleagues to close my door. I decided the latter. It was at this moment that I thought about the trauma of my childhood. At my workplace, a black male student getting stomped out is not a random occurrence. Skull stomping happens all of the time. Students usually rush from other classrooms to record it to be the first to upload it to Facebook. My other colleagues watch these fights in their free time. Upon hiring, I was told by the school administration that these things happen. I am never given a lesson plan, so I create my own. I'm expected to give every student a passing grade, regardless of effort or attendance. I was hired not to teach black teens, but to babysit and falsify grades. Students are expected to use their devices to access the online platform to participate in this class. Students are expected to watch videos and answer questions. Genuine lesson engagement does not happen. Instead, there is a purposeful confusion that lacks order. Students leave the school during my class to buy bacon, egg, and cheese sandwiches and self-medicate with marijuana. Then they sneak back into my class so they can both record and watch TikTok videos during class time, standing up, walking around with no headphones, and the volume turned up to the highest setting. Often, while I'm going over instructions to an assignment, students will stand, place their phones against the chalkboard, and record themselves dancing to the latest dance trend. This behavior seems to be entirely acceptable for academic administrators. Both my parents never graduated high school. I can't and do not talk to them. And I am teaching in the same classrooms where my mother learned, met my father, and decided to give birth to me at 16. This realization made me ask myself, why am I here? What am I doing? 2 years and 4 months ago, after repeatedly failing practice 5039, which prohibited me from participating in my student practicum placement examination and graduating on time, I began working at the location where I now teach. I took over for a black teacher who had me teach The Crucible, whose major themes focus on the destructive power of lies, the importance of reputation, hysteria, and corruption. The Crucible serves as a historical drama, and it offers an emphasis on the symbolism behind being black and invisible and being white in America. I had a class of all black males. I decided this would be an excellent opportunity to teach people.
Sponsored by the Lou Rawls Parade of Stars and the United Negro College Fund.
HOF, Hall of Fame year. I said for years, nobody has better introductions for their program than the Cows. Buddy, Hall of Fame year. You got to have at least one Hall of Fame intro on the way out, buddy. Have to break that one down a little bit as we go, but most of that should be self-evident as we proceed. Young academic right at the center, victim of white supremacy, privileged black male, Gus T. Renegade, worthless Negro from Virginia, in for another broadcast, Context of White Supremacy. Today's date, Monday, December 26, 2022. So I have been told. Hopefully everybody survived White Jesus' birthday. If you did not have to be at work and all the rest of it, you could do constructive things, get some rest, eat quality food, no chitlins. Lots of Brussels sprouts, asparagus, kale, lots of healthy vegan sweet potato pie. Anywho, I said no vacations for the Cows, so we were not on yesterday, not because of shiftlessness and laziness on my part, really, just preparing because I said we'll be on every day this week. We broadcasted every day last week, except for Tuesday, I believe. So, I mean, we have done our diligence for the holiday season. Forget 12 days of Christmas. Every day is counter-racism, white supremacy, the Cows. Now, this broadcast specifically, I guess I would say, too, man, it's been 14 years that we've been broadcasting, so I have to think about some things. Many times over the years, I'll start programs, I'll say sometimes, I flip to the end for the references just to see which Cows guests are in the reference section. Some of the times when I do that and I see lots of names of people that are here, I think sometimes people hear this program like, oh my gosh, that Negro is uppity and sassy. Who is he talking to these white people like that? Well, most of the time it's because, dang, I did my homework, I read their work, and they're referencing people that we've already talked to. So, for today's program. I am super excited because this is such an important topic. We have black teachers. And then when I flip to the references, oh my goodness, Dr. William A. Smith, Racial Battle Fatigue. He was here. Matter of fact, I had such a chuckle because he was here November 2016, just after you-know-who won the election. That was such a hilarious time to talk about racial battle fatigue. Number two, Dr. Travis Bristol, the very topic, dearth of black male teachers. He was here with us before. Dr. Frank B. Wilderson, two-time guest on the cows. Dorothy Roberts, not one, not two, a three-time guest on the cows. Anytime when I look at a report like that, I woo, man, we should at least be halfway competent to talk about this in an intelligent manner. And even to my masterful clip at the beginning, I included, "You're a monster, Mr. Nigger, because of Joseph Gibson, the monsters we make unconscious racism and stereotype-based teacher expectations in the 21st century urban classroom." Guest on our program, I reviewed the book. There's only one monster on the planet, privileged black male. The Batman, or it wasn't Batman, it was Black Man, but even that was played for a reason. We'll get to that one down the road. Our guest for today's program, whew, so excited for the subject matter. I said they would not even allow me in the library. System of White Supremacy, Racism, like, oh man, we got to go back to the old days. You, Gus T, are not allowed at the library. I told you all, I found so many things at the library the last 2 to 3 visits. I had to go back and review, like, what did you get? Like, oh my God, that's right. This was one. Forgot that I even picked it up. I was there. One of our favorite subject matters, black male privilege. Just decided to look while I had a little extra time before I exited the university library. What did I put my hands on? 2021 dissertation, When They See Us, Narratives of Black Male Teachers. We have a lot of black educators who listen to this program. You heard young academic right at the beginning of the program. I thought they might be interested in hearing about this because this is such a major problem. We will start our program with the dedication from this dissertation we will discuss. It reads to Mary A. Lomax, the woman who raised me, I love you so much. Accomplishing this degree was for you, Ma. To all the black male teachers, all 5 of them, who are dedicated to the profession and continue to persist despite the challenges you are up against, this is also for you. Mary A. Lomax. Very proud, I'm sure. Our guest wrote this here dissertation that we are excited to chat it up about. In addition, he is the chair and associate professor of academic literacies at Anne Arundel Community College. So thankful that he could share a bit of his, I guess, holiday season with us. He could have been hanging out with his family and doing other things, relaxing. And he shared a little bit of his Monday evening, Boxing Day, with us. We are so grateful. Our guest joining us live, Dr. Antione D. Tomlin. Dr. Tomlin, are you with us, sir?
I am here. I'm super excited about it.
We are excited and grateful to have you, sir. For any of our listening audience, I'm sure for many folks this is their first time hearing from you. Can you tell us about some of the great work that you do as the Associate Professor of Academic Literacies?
So right now, and I'm taking a much-needed break, right? But as Associate Professor, I teach, just like all of my other colleagues, mostly developmental English, actually. So you can imagine what the makeup of my department in terms of student population, who we serve, what it looks like. And we can get into my thoughts around why it might look like so many students of color in those courses. So it's the developmental English department, and we really serve students who just need a refresher or maybe who didn't do well on those standardized tests that we need to just get rid of, and to get them to college level, right, so that they can take all of their other courses and go on and be successful. So outside of teaching, I also run a department, which is, it's important work, I will say that, right, and we can get into also why it's important for me to sit in that position as a Black male. But oftentimes, just like the participants from a lot of my research studies, right, I end up sometimes being the go-to Black man, because I know what I'm doing, right? Or that's at least what people say. And I end up being a disciplinarian, right? Like, I have to put out all of the fires, ensure that's a part of the job. And there's some things where I'm like, this is not a part of your job, but you have made it a part of my job. And so, you know, again, it's important work for me to lead faculty, but it does sometimes feel like I'm being asked to do things that my white colleagues are not, right? So then I'm working twice as hard as my colleagues just to say that I'm competent at what I do.
Echo, echo, echo. Feel like I've heard that before 10 or 50 million times maybe. Thank you so much for sharing. And yes, we shout to Mary A. Lomax. Is that all right?
Yeah.
For sure. Developmental English. What you gave us some of the details. What is that exactly? And yes, what are the demographics of the students who are in the developmental English program?
So I'll give you a little bit of the context behind. Right now, our institution is on not necessarily a self-placement model, but we have some alternative measures for how students entering the college place into their courses. So one could be GPA. So we look at the GPA. If you have a certain GPA, then we say, okay, you're ready for what we call English 101, which is college composition, right? So it's that first level of English, college level. So that's one way. We also still use the standardized testing, so ACT and SAT, to determine, right? So that's another way that you can do it. And then we have some other measures where you could potentially write an essay to demonstrate that you are ready to roll into college-level English. If at any point those measures determine, right, I think that's the word I want to use, determine that you are not ready for college-level English, then you will need to take a 5-credit course that says you need a refresher, and we need to get you up to speed before you can go into your college-level English. And so that course really focuses on critical reading and writing all throughout the semester. And this semester, what I've tried to do in my own courses is to revamp a little bit, because we know that, sure, it is important to be able to read and write. And I'm not sure that having students crank out 4 traditional essays a semester is going to help them moving forward. And so I'm thinking about what are the skills that they actually need and how can I assess that and allow them to demonstrate that they've got the skills outside of just a traditional research or essay-based paper. So the course is designed to do just that, right? And so I've been really pushing all of my faculty members to also think about how could you still tap into seeing what the students are learning and how they are using the skills that they're learning without just saying, okay, now you write this paper, right? And so I've done a lot of different things this semester to think about what are some of those things, right? So we've written letters to the Board of Education, actually, telling them how crappy the educational system is. And so, again, that's something that not only can they pull in their lived experiences, they then can take this and go, right? And I'm like, hey, you can actually send it, whether you want to put it in the mail or send an email, send it to the Board of Education so that they know exactly, right, how, one, you're grappling with what feels like a disadvantage because you went through your K-12 experience, you showed up to college, and then somebody said, oh, no, you're not ready for college level. You need to take this refresher course, right? And by the way, pay for it, and it's a lot of money, right? And so those are some of the things that I want students to be thinking about, especially how does this systemic racism, discrimination, all of the like fit into their lived experiences, and then what does it look like for them when they show up to this college environment? And so also to answer your question, most of the students in the developmental English program are students of color.
I guess germane to our chat for today in terms of a gender breakdown. What percentage, if you, I mean, it doesn't have to be exact, you know, to the hundredth decimal place or anything, but do you know, like, approximately what percentage are black males specifically?
Mm-hmm. So we actually have a really, really small percentage of black males. And so if I had to even think about one of my courses, each section caps at 15. Mm-hmm. I want to say last semester I had two black males out of 15 students. And I taught two sections last semester across both sections, so 50 or 30 students. I had a total of three black males out of 30 students.
Hmm. Okay. Right. Mm-hmm. On. I guess black males.
Also,
oh, yes, go ahead. Sorry.
I'm going to say, I'll go on to say, so that number is representative across all of the sections, right? That's what I'm seeing this academic year, and that's what I've seen in the past as well. I also will say, out of when I look at the data across all sections for a given academic semester and then a given academic year, it looks the same. And most of our black males are not successfully completing the course, which means that they need to go back and take it again. And then we need to figure out what financial aid and all these other things look like. And so when I became the department chair, I made it a personal mission to figure out what's happening. And the few black males who were passing, they went on to English 101 and then they did not pass, right? So there are all of these exit points for our black male students. And it's a problem for me, whether it's one student, three students, 10 black male students. I was like, we need to figure this out. We need to look and take a deep dive at what's happening that, one, the black males that we have are not passing this course. And the ones that do go on to the next course and they don't pass, right? So I've made it a personal mission over the last 2 years to think about, how do we look at this differently? What's happening? How do we make sure that we show up and show out for all of our students, but especially our black male students, because those are the ones who are not being supported in a way that is going to allow them to successfully complete this course and move on to degree attainment.
Thought I got my, there we go.
Double whammy.
Yes, indeed. Another teaspoon of black male privilege there. Wow, I'm so glad that I, wow, that is great context to begin with. Again, our guest, Dr. Tomlin, chatting it up. We're about to get into his his fresh dissertation just came out last year. I feel like you've already kind of shared, but just make sure we make it plain. You are a black male. Is that correct, Dr. Tomlin?
Yes, I identify as a black male. I am a black male.
Right on. You've already used the term. We'll do it this way. What is your definition of the term racism? When you use that term, you mean?
Mm-hmm. Ooh, I feel like that can be a whole thing in and of itself. So the bottom line, for me, racism is when folks who don't look like me, right? So, and I use the term non-black and specifically white, right? In the United States, benefit from all of the privileges of who they are and what they look like just because of who they are, right? And so when those folks who don't look like me, white folks, show up and they have a privilege just because of what they look like, and it puts me or any person who looks like me or of color at a disadvantage just because of what we look like, right, you get to benefit from. And so for me, it also is about yes, the blatant racism, I think it's important for us to say, right? Like, that's what you can feel, what you can see, what you can hear. But it's also that underlying tone of you as a white person benefit and are privileged to live in this society just because of what you look like and all of the systemic structures that have been put into place to help you be successful and succeed, which in turn also put me at a disadvantage.
Okay. I wrote that down. Much obliged, sir. So I got, you can, I'm paraphrasing here for what I wrote down. White people who do not look like you benefit mm-hmm. from all of the privileges accrued in this part of the world, U.S., where they are able to show up, white people, and just because of what they look like, they are able to put people of color, non-white people like yourself, at a disadvantage. Is that kind of the gist of your definition for racism?
Yes.
Okay. Bravo. We always start our program definition of racism. I think that is super important because many people have different definitions of racism, and a lot of times people will be conversing as though we all have the same definition, and I found that that is not the case at all. The definition that I use for racism, I use racism and white supremacy as synonyms. Same definition for both terms. The definition I use is as follows: a global system of people who classify themselves as white and are dedicated to abusing and or subjugating everyone in the known universe whom they classify as not white. Actually, we'll pause there. When I promoted this broadcast, they had a report 7 days ago about the lack of black teachers, black male teachers specifically, but it was not from the U.S. It was from the U.K. Exact same problem. But that's my definition for white supremacy and racism. Do you think that that is an accurate definition, that such a system exists?
I do.
Right on. Let's see, before we pivot to the dissertation, man, we are so like lock step in rhythm with what we are supposed to do. One, with what he just said about developmental English, we in our book club, we are reading Mahmoud Abdul-Rauf, In the Blink of an Eye. I didn't even want to read that book, for shame, Gus T. He said when he went to LSU, he had to be placed in the remedial reading class. And guess what? He didn't have a black male teacher. No way. He had Echo. As a matter of fact, let's do it this way. You want to? I don't know if you've read this book or not. It's pretty brand new. It's newer than your dissertation, Dr. Tomlin. Do you want to guess who this black male, Mahmoud Abdul-Rauf, who was basically in the developmental English class at LSU, do you want to guess who his teacher was?
Huh. I don't know. Who
in terms of demographics, that type of thing, like black male, that type of thing.
Yeah, white.
Say it again.
White woman.
A plus scholar. But I mean, that's, you know, low bar. Of course. And he specifically, just days ago we read, he talked about it was such a degrading experience and having her talk down to him and all the rest of it. And he had Tourette's syndrome. Oh, my God. I didn't even want to read the book. And it's the best thing I've read this year. Easily. It's not even close. But we just read that on Friday. That's one. Two, I have been talking, or I can't even do it that way. I have to do it the other way. This dissertation, he's specifically talking about the lack of black male teachers in Baltimore, Maryland. Man, oh man. I just said his name Friday, the same freaking book. He mentioned Hank Gathers first, and I said, oh man, oh, black male privilege. And I said, Lynn Bias, were you born in Maryland, Dr. Tomlin?
Yes, I was born in Baltimore, Maryland, and still here.
Lynn, but can I... Lynn, but if I say Lynn Bias, you would say
nothing.
Oh man, do you know you are aware? You know who Lynn Bias is?
A little.
Oh, okay. A little bit. Went to the University of Maryland. Another teaspoon of black male privilege. Went to the University of Maryland and was drafted by the Celtics. He was going to be a big star, play with Larry Bird and everything, and then died right after he was drafted. Very sad story, but I just was talking about Lynn Bias, and then, bam, to be talking about Maryland and all this black male privilege, like, wow. Your dissertation, and even the school experience is right there with Lynn Bias. Anyway, your whole dissertation, I'm going to steal a sentence from your report. It's way, way, way later on, but I think this is a great point to start at. You way later on write, I engaged in self-reflection, especially around my own experiences of race and education as I posed racially and culturally grounded questions to myself. I said, you just told us you born and raised in the state of Maryland. Lynn Bias, Freddie Gray. What was your experience as a black male student in the state of Maryland with the system of racism, white supremacy?
That's a good question. So I also went to Baltimore City Public Schools all through K-12. And I actually just wrote about this experience as well in the book chapter about a few weeks ago. I did not get into one of the schools that had selective admissions. And so what that meant is I didn't do well on whatever that standardized test was, like picking eighth grade. And so because I didn't get into any of the schools that I chose, I got shuffled to a zone school. And at the time, my zone school didn't necessarily have a particularly good reputation. And so it was terrible. I didn't go to school the first month of ninth grade. And when I finally went, it wasn't bad. However, it was underfunded and no resources, and they were trying the best they could. We also had a ton of new teachers coming through the Teach for America program. Many of them not from Baltimore, had never lived in Maryland, and were fresh out of undergrad, right? So you can imagine coming to a low-income resource institution. The teachers didn't know what was going on or what to do. They also didn't have any teaching experience. And so you got to see that and what it looked like through a lot of the experiences that we had as students, right? Now, I will say I went on once I finally was like, okay, I'm here and I need to make the best of it, because I am first generation college student, but I'm also the first person to graduate from high school with an actual high school diploma in my family as well. And so I had a point to prove. So I went, I showed up, I said, okay, I need to do this. I ended up graduating top of my class. So I ended up graduating salutatorian, second in the class, and I went off to school. At the time, my high school was predominantly black. And the teachers were predominantly white. Surprise, right? So I said, I want a different experience. I ended up going to Stevenson University in Owings Mills, Maryland, which is a predominantly white private liberal arts institution, because I wanted a different experience. And so I wanted to go to school with folks who looked like me and who didn't. But to my surprise, when I got to Stevenson, graduating second in my class, I needed to take developmental classes. And I said, well, what in the world is happening here? And so I did. I took developmental math. I also took developmental English, right? And so my students now, they're like, you had to take this course? I'm like, yeah, I did actually, right? but it was a shock to me because I got there and I said, well, how could this be, right? I'm top of the class. I did everything I was supposed to do. I had a great GPA, right? And then I got to college with folks who didn't look like me and who, in my opinion, were a lot smarter than me. And all of the imposter syndrome and everything kicked in. And so going back to my experience with Baltimore City, it wasn't my teachers, my brand new teachers, right? It wasn't their fault that they didn't know what they were doing at the time. But because Baltimore City didn't take the time to invest in my high school, just like many other schools across the city and district, I felt like I had to suffer the impact of those consequences when I went to college. And so, sure, I had a great time in high school, but I didn't get some of the necessities that I needed in order to set me up for success when I went on to college. And, you know, for me, that's a very real thing. And that's also why I've shaped and crafted my approach and my pedagogy to supporting especially students of color, because many, not all, right? So I'm not going to make a blanket generalized statement, but many students have a very similar experience to mine. And then they show up to college and they're upset and they're angry because they didn't get what they needed in order to be successful.
Thank you for such a rich answer. We'll have to get that book. What book is this in where you just wrote a chapter about all of this, sir?
Oh, I want to say it's not published yet, but to be honest, I'm on break, but this is my research time, so my head is spinning around. I'm going to look it up with one, right? Because I'm like, I'm doing this and I'm doing that and it, right? So I will look it up, but I want to say it's coping mechanisms for first generation college students or black first generation college students, something like that. The book should be released early next year, I think.
Okay, right on. So it hasn't even been published yet. Awesome. We'll be on the lookout. That sounds great. I know we have folks who have children college age and look for constructive reading, but wow, that is wow. So now you've got time to reflect. I will definitely say my white peers throughout kindergarten all the way through were way smarter than myself, no contest. Do you think that was the case, or do you think that was just like imposter syndrome and, I was just feeling kind of overwhelmed with the environment? Do you really think that they were actually more informed, smarter than you at that time?
Mm-hmm. So as I reflect now, some absolutely, and some of them became my best friends, right? And so we still are in communication even now. So yes, some. Others, I'm not going to say they weren't, but I think it was me having to do the work to say, no, you actually do belong here. You need to show up. You need to stand in your blackness. You need to stand in your brilliance, and you need to get the job done, right? Instead of thinking about, oh, I need to compare myself to X, Y, and Z. And remember, I went to a private liberal arts white institution, right? So almost everyone who I was comparing myself to didn't look like me, right? So that part kind of played a role in my psyche too, of like, oh, I'm getting in my own way. And I also will share, I do have a book that I'm excited about this because it was a project we were working on earlier this year. It was supposed to be released early next year. And the publishing company was like, just kidding, we're done, right? So the book was just released. It's called Black Experiences in Higher Education, Faculty, Staff, and Students. And I dig into this. It's an edited volume with one of my really good friends and colleagues, Dr. Shirella Cupid. We dig into this idea of what does that experience look like. And this is one of the first books that we found that really shares faculty, staff, and students' Black experiences all together, right? And so I'm excited about seeing, right, what responses we're going to get from this one that was just released. But yeah, we do dig into some of that as well, thinking about the imposter syndrome and how you show up in spaces that maybe are not designed to support you, and what does it look like for you to keep going to be successful to reach those goals.
Reading more important than watching television. Lots of books, literature to check, especially again, if folks, we have educators and or if you are attempted black parents and you have children, lots of material for you to check out, read, pass on. Dr. Antione D. Tomlin, one they can include the report we're discussing this evening, When They See Us, Narratives of Black Male Teachers, his dissertation just published last year. Let's see, so many things to dig in on this one. I guess I'll start with number one. What was your motivation to write this project specifically focused on black male educators, and did you encounter resistance to this sort of investigation?
Mm-hmm. Good question. So to be honest, when I started the process, I said, you know what? I'm going to focus on black male students. That's what I want to do. That's what I did in my master's program. And by the time I was ready to write the dissertation, it was well overdone. And so my mentor and chair, she was like, we're not doing that. And I was like, what do you mean we're not doing that? Yes, we are doing that, right? And so I had to think about what else lights up my core values. What else am I going to be passionate about? What else, right, for 2.5 years I'm going to want to, be with, right? Because it's a relationship. And so I started thinking, because I had already been teaching as well. So I'm finishing year 10 of teaching in higher education. I cannot even believe I'm coming up on year 10, finishing this academic year. So I said, that makes perfect sense. Now, I also will say I've never been a K-12 educator in a full-time capacity. I knew early on that it was not for me. And folks were like, but you're so patient. I'm like, but no, only because, right, I have so much respect for, and my patience is probably a little bit thin, right? And so I was like, no, I can't go through the K-12 journey. However, a lot of my friends and mentors are in K-12, and I got to see and hear about a lot of their experiences. And so it made perfect sense for me to say, you know what, if I can't focus on Black male students, then I want to focus on Black male teachers, and specifically K-12, because that was not my experience. And so I dug in, and I found a lot of things, which we can get into, but a lot of things and experiences that I didn't even know were possible. One of the things I will share that didn't make it into the dissertation was this notion around Black male teachers in K-12 being sexually harassed by their Black female leaders. And so that was one thing I'm like, what? That's not even, I wasn't even on my radar to think about, right? So that's one of the nuggets that I found that didn't make it into the dissertation, but it's something that's very real that I don't think is talked about enough.
Oh, my jaw hit the ground. My jaw hit the ground. How did that get left out?
So, a piece of advice that I got when I was going through my program and trying to finish up, because it initially was in the dissertation, it ended up being way too long in terms of like my analysis chapter of how I was going to write out the findings. And my chairs, they said, I had two chairs. They said, you don't have to include everything, one. Two, you need to make sure that you go back to, right, this is the foundation. And so it made sense when they told me, but I'm like, no, I want to add everything. Go back to your research questions, right? You only need to put in things that are going to address the research questions. And then, right, after you finish, you can go back and share, present, and write more about all of the other data that you found. So there's a lot of things that didn't make it into the dissertation just by nature of you need to only write to answer the research question, and it doesn't need to be 300 pages.
Wowzers, that knocked off a whole everything. Oh, my goodness. Jiminy Crickets. Let me see. Let me back up here. So your dissertation was directed by Dr. Christine Mallinson and Dr. Keisha Allen. Dr. Mallinson, is this a white woman?
Yes.
Okay. And Dr. Keisha Allen, non-white female, she would be classified as a Black female. Is that correct?
Yes, she's a Black woman. Yep.
Okay. They tell me patriarchy. That's what they say, man. Young academic sound clip at the beginning. Now, he's called in many times to talk about his experience, Black male teacher. He said he was sexually harassed by a white female teacher. In his, he talked about that, and in fact said that that was a part of the harassment in his career. In fact, he talked about it two times. He talked about it at the graduate school level as well, going through and being harassed and saying, dang, she was trying to hook me up with this other white woman, and it seemed like our relationship deteriorated because I wasn't interested in swirling. I just wanted to focus on getting my degree. Mm-hmm. That is in context, because I don't think that's an anomaly either. I think that is... That is in context with, we are in an environment where people say, hey, particularly Black males, you are always a rapist. You are always a perpetrator of sexual violence. It's not even possible. We just had a news clip, Neutralizing Workplace Racism, where they had a human resources presentation saying that, hey, we can't be making flirtatious comments to male staff and whatever. And they said people broke out laughing like, what? Males can't be victims of sexual harassment. And they had to stop and bring people back as that gang. This is, please stop cackling. This is not funny. Yes. Mm-hmm. Males can be victims of sexual violence, sexual harassment, rape, all of that. In fact, mm-hmm. I just had to, we had a white guest on, Ben Gahol. Oh my God. Oh my God. Oh, Ben Green was on, not for a basketball program. He was on talking about the history of the Harlem Globetrotters. Man, I don't suspect you're old enough to know about, you know, their whole history. No, I wasn't either. Their theme song is Sweet Georgia Brown, which is a black whore, a song about a black whore, prostitute. I didn't know that till I started doing all of this history. Man, reading that book about these black males, and I had to tell Ben Green, like, there's a whole history of black males being sexually exploited, sexually vulnerable. That's a long history of white supremacy, racism. Thomas A. Foster's book, Rethinking Rufus, guest on this program. That's the whole thesis. Like, dang, we are totally ignoring all of that. There's a long history, delectable Negro, long history of black males being victims of sexual violence from white women, white men. Dr. Tomlin said this was other black female staff members. That's in Mahmoud Abdul-Rauf's book. He said that it was a black female teacher who was having sex with a black male student, 17-year-old. For that to be I mean, I get it. Yes. You can't talk about everything. We can't include everything. Dissertation is supposed to be capped, but I am submitting, and particularly the directors are both females. One of them, white woman. That is an enormous component of white supremacy, racism. It must be deliberate where we have to ignore, minimize, obfuscate black males as victim, not the rapist. We got all that. Yes, mandatory black male rapist. Yes, yes, yes. But victims of sexual harassment, violence, and rape. Wow, that is... commentary, Dr. Tomlin?
I think you hit the nail on the head. It's super important. And like we've been talking about, it's not shared enough. I'm grateful because it came up multiple times across my 10 participants, actually, right? It wasn't just one participant who shared an experience like that. It was more so about half of them who at some point shared. And I'm grateful that they did because I was able to not highlight that part of who their experience has shaped them into being and how they use that experience to actually go on and still be successful in their classrooms. But I'm grateful because I'm able to, one, take that to another place, right? So while I didn't make it into the dissertation and it wasn't shared in that way, it did make it into other spaces, right? Like this, and to write about it in a different way, in a different platform and medium. And I'm grateful that they felt comfortable enough to share that experience with me. And some of what they shared with me is that, well, I didn't report it or I didn't say anything because of just what we're talking about, that narrative and notion that black men can't be, right, having these experiences. And some of them felt very, very ashamed, right, about it, right, to say, well, no, I can't say anything because, one, maybe people are not going to believe me or it's going to be flipped, right? The narrative is going to be flipped and then I'm going to be the one who's going to get in trouble for something that, right, like, was put onto me. and so we need to be thinking about that, too. Right. And why black males maybe don't share these experiences. And I think that it happens far more often than we're aware of.
Oh, man. Context of white supremacy. We don't do holidays. This is why, because we have so much work to do. Again, speaking with Mary A. Lomax's child, Dr. Antione D. Tomlin. Are you familiar with Dr. Tommy J. Curry? Are you familiar with his work?
No, I'm not.
You just a friendly suggestion. I'm a no-count black person, you know, no-count black male potential rapist, so you don't have to take my suggestions. But Dr. Tommy J. Curry, oh my gosh, his book, The Man Knot, Race, Class, Genre, and the Dilemmas of Black Manhood, is so that's how I know about Thomas A. Foster's book. He talks about that specifically. His book has a whole section talking about that specifically, our unwillingness, how he has been mocked and even trying to talk about
Black males are raped. Black males are victims of sexual violence. And he's been laughed at and mocked by others in the academy and trying. He's a black male and trying to present this work and doing his scholarship. Even the whole term black misandry. He's the person. That's how I know about Thomas A. Foster's work. We had him on the program again, rethinking Rufus. Like, wow, Rufus the slave is a victim of sexual violence. And we don't even talk about that. That's ignored or deliberately suppressed from our thinking, understanding of white supremacy, racism. But I said that so many times, I think his scholarship would add a lot of value, even some of his concepts that he presents in that book, The Man Knot, Race, Class, Genre, and the Dilemmas of Black Manhood. It is, wowzers, he would, what you just shared, he would love to read that. Even how does that not get included? And he would even be thinking now, okay, so if we were talking about white women, if we did a study and half of the white women that we talked to, half had an experience of sexual harassment, do you think the directors, yeah, we can't include everything. You know, it can't be 500, baby. Me too. That's already been talked about. Move that along. Really? If they were LGBTQ and classified as white and they were getting some sort of harassment about that, half of the participants in the study. So, I mean, it's not like this was one person and kind of a, with a sketchy report. This is half of them. And that doesn't get in. The Man Knot, Race, Class, Genre, and Dilemmas of Black Manhood. My gosh, so consistent. Did I cut you off there, Dr. Tomlin?
No, you didn't. I'm listening, and I just added the book to my cart. Amazon is sent to me, so I'm busy over here.
Listeners, you should do it the same thing. Do the same thing. If you do not have it on your shelf, that is a great one. Just talked about books to get. You can get Dr. Tomlin's work and Dr. Tommy J. Curry, The Man Knot, Race, Class, Genre, and the Dilemmas of Black Manhood. Mandatory read. In fact, we read it on the book club here. Mandatory read. Let's see. Lost that I got discombobulated. Man, I can get back to where I went. Now, keep in mind what we just heard. Half of the folks that we're hearing from, I'm quoting from, reading from, said they were victims of some sort of sexual harassment from female colleagues on the job. Now, this is on page six here of Dr. Tomlin's dissertation, When They See Us, Narratives of Black Male Teachers. He writes, make sure I give full, there we go, I'll back up and read it. As professionals, black male teachers must often deal with feelings of lack of support and preparation, similar feelings that they may have experienced throughout their own prior educational journeys. Preach. With regard to lack of support, Pabon's study with four black male teachers in New York City found that they felt pressured to standardize their curriculum. These teachers believed that the curriculum needed more explicitly relevant content to students in their classrooms. However, they were strongly encouraged to use the materials that the schools had adopted. As a result, black male teachers experienced their schools as hostile environments where the administration hyper-monitored their adherence to the curriculum. In this way, once black male teachers have entered teaching positions, they may not be challenged or encouraged to use innovative materials in ways that would allow them to be autonomous in their teaching approaches. Pabon concluded that black male teachers, despite often being conceptualized as black supermen, teachers who are viewed as key role models for helping black students develop skills to succeed in school, which in turn is viewed as a panacea to improving urban schools, often feel under-supported and pushed out at the very schools that claim to need them the most. This kind of paradox I observed throughout your work, but man, that's why I said, man, Every component of that introduction was deliberate. I just didn't do the Superman. I did the Batman parody Black Man, but black males as Supermen, I can't even stop other black females from molesting and harassing me. I'm Superman. I don't get any support. Can you how they're thought of as Supermen in one sense and then totally pushed out and not supported in the other?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, sir. Go ahead.
Yeah. It's this interesting thing, right? Because we know that black men still represent less than 2% of the teaching profession. And we've had all of these calls and charges to say we need to recruit. We need to get more black male teachers. And so we think about these pipeline programs, these different type of prep programs that are designed to recruit more black male teachers. And some of them do it well, right? But the other piece to that is, now what does retention of black male teachers look like? Because that's the true problem, right? It's not that black men don't want to teach, right? But it is that the ones who are going into teaching, many of them don't stay. Right. Because of all of these things. And so in the dissertation, I talk about the different positions and roles that the black men in the study felt like they played, whether it was something that they welcomed in terms of the positional role or something that was kind of bestowed upon them and then kind of forced into it. And so when we hire these black male teachers, right, some of the ways in which the school system expects them to show up is that idea of, I call it in my dissertation, the policer or the school monitor, right? And which is really the disciplinary, and a lot of research talks about that in some way. And so for my research, I just call it the police or the school monitor, right? If you can police and monitor, especially students of color, right, then you're automatically great at your job, and you came in and you've done what needed to be done. And so we say that you are a great teacher. Never mind, right, we've never observed you actually teach. What we observed was you making sure that your students are in line, right? Many of them who look like you. We also have observed you making sure that everyone else's students are in line, many who also look like you, right? And so this creates this narrative of Superman, right? Because you can do it all. Again, never mind that we've never seen you actually teach. Right. But you can do everything that we need you to do, which is to keep black and brown bodies in line. Right. And when you don't do that, right, then we say, okay, something's not right. In my dissertation, I also talk about, and I love the opening clip, about the praxis and how many of the teachers actually didn't go through a traditional teacher education prep program. And so they weren't familiar with even the layout of what the praxis means, what it looks like, what it feels like, right? And so multiple teachers failed it multiple times because they just didn't have the experience of prepping in that way. They also, many of them were hired last minute, so they were thrown into the classroom maybe the day before, right? So not only did they not go through a teacher prep program that maybe would have given them some of the foundation and basics, right? They didn't know how to lesson plan. They didn't know how to do all of the things, right? And they didn't have time to figure it out because they were thrown right into the academic year, right? All of that on top of, you then don't give me support, right? And what it looks like to continuously grow and develop as a teacher. But at some point, then I do need to be observed, right? And then that's when, oh, but you're not doing anything right, right? But you didn't give me all year, right, the opportunity to learn and grow, right? I didn't get a mentor. And so we see our black male teachers then held to the same standard as everyone else with no support, right? And then it becomes the problem, right? Well, you didn't pass the practice, so now you don't have a job. Or you're not doing it the way that we said that you need to do it, right? Here's the curriculum. You're supposed to teach it like this. Again, never mind that the curriculum was built and designed for white students.
Context of white supremacy set up to fail, that all of that is so painfully familiar in the classroom and beyond, not getting support from supervisors, colleagues, other staff that you work with, being thrown right into the classroom. We're talking about black males, but our Bay Area mom, she teaches out in California, just happened to her, just get tossed right in there. Well, wait a minute. You gotta, what kind of training? Anything? Like, I don't even know the layout of the classroom. Who are these children? Do they have behavior? Like, yeah, you'll figure it out. Get in there. Get in there. Yeah, yeah. Like, whoa. No mentorship, resources, nothing. We've had tons of young academic as well who talked about that. Nothing. And you get the tough, the challenging students. We'll put old Jamal in here, who's not been in school in the last 3 years. He's in the seventh grade, but he reads at a first grade level. You get Jamal and Leroy, same type of profile. We'll put all of them in your class, and you can handle it because you are a super nigger. You can handle it. Do what? Do what? And then I don't get any support. Like, what? They're going to come in and monitor me, make sure that I'm leaving a... That's what, when I hear that metaphor being used, it, these are the things that come to mind for me. One, I've heard it all my life, that black people are so strong because of what we have endured. And I mean, wow, slavery and everything, we've been through so much, and we are such strong people that, boy, they can just put that black woman in there, and boy, she can have, look at everything she's been through, and put that black man in it. That's one. I say that is, I mean, you want to talk about highfalutin hogwash, like, ooh, being a victim of white supremacy racism does not make you strong. That should be self-evident, but frequently the exact opposite is said. Those lashes on the plantation, woo, made us the strongest people ever. The other component is the fit back to exactly that, really, the physicality, especially with black males, because as Superman, you think of some, you don't think of a wimpy, you know, 90 pound person. You think of big muscles and big strong biceps and just someone who can fly and bend steel with his hand. That's the rapist black male, that, oh, Mr. Big Black Male with those muscles, and he can knock down a whole wall. He'll get Jamal in line. That is super nigger. He will make sure Jamal, and you see that? See his big muscles? He'll grab you and bust you upside your head. Like, he's raped about 5 people on the way to school this morning, so you better behave, Jamal. That's kind of like neither one of those. Like, you're going to work me to death and pay me 5 cents, monitor me, give me the worst conditions. That's not Superman. That is just total abuse and mistreatment. And then the other is what you said about the disciplinarian, that I'm Superman. So you give me all of the students that are going to need to be physically restrained, and because I'm big, tough, black, plantation-molded, muscled Negro. Am I making sense? What do you think, Dr. Tomlin?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Context of white supremacy. I've said that slavery has not made us super people, not Superman, not Superwoman. Love Stevie Wonder, too. The praxis was mentioned in the intro. Young academic talked about that and failing it many times and all the money. Oh, you have to go back and take it again, and time and energy. Dr. Travis Bristol, Stanford, again, go Cardinal. We talked about that when he visited with us. How is, it doesn't have to be the praxis specifically, but these standardized tests, you would have some folks, they might give pushback and say, hey, we want teachers to be well-trained. These standardized tests, that is a method of making sure that we're not just letting anybody in to teach our children. There has to be some means of gauging whether or not this person is informed. He can come in here and teach our children, right?
Yes. And I have so many thoughts about the praxis. And to be honest, I think we just need to get rid of it. I know some folks are like, no, we need to keep it. And I'm like, how is that truly a measure of if you are going to be able to step into a classroom and to support a student holistically? Sure, right? There's certain things that the district is going to say they need to be exposed to, right, in order to successfully go on to the next grade. And I think the rapport, the relational rapport, the approach to how you care for and support your students is much more important, right? And so I think to be honest, and the other parts of this is with the practice, right, there are two, right, that you need to take in order to be certified in Maryland anyway. One of them is very general, right? And so it goes over all of the subjects. Many of my actual close friends have failed the practice because of a portion that is not within their content area, right? So, for instance, my math folks, right, they're like, English is not my jam. And so they run into more challenges with that part of the practice because they're not teaching English in the classroom, right? Like, if you're not pre-K through five, you are not teaching all of the subjects. And so you're teaching in your content area and discipline. And so that's so important, right? So I'm wondering, what does it look like to reimagine what that certification process could be, right? Is it a portfolio? Is it a performance evaluation? Is it something else versus the standardized test that we have said for decades now is just a terrible mess, but that's the only thing that we still have, right? So what does it look like to do away with the practice altogether is something that I'm very curious about, and seeing what are the ways might we be able to say, yeah, sure, you've checked whatever box we want you to check in order to say that you can step into a classroom and be successful. And in fact, I did find that many teachers who are not certified are far better than some of the teachers who did the whole check the box. I did all the things, now I'm a certified teacher. They step into the classroom and they leave the first year, right? Because they weren't exposed to, or it wasn't what they imagined that it was going to be. And the practice can't do that for you.
Are you aware of people classified as white who, you know, have struggled with the praxis where they've had to take it 2-3 times or what have you, or that was a real obstacle for them being able to be in the classroom?
I am aware of some folks who are white who struggled, and I'm also aware that they've gotten far more chances than folks who look like me with their job security, right? And so, oh, you didn't pass it this time, you take it again next time, and we'll pay for it again too.
Wow.
Right? Versus black men especially, right? Like, oh, you didn't pass it, right? You got this amount of time to figure it out because we're not renewing your contract next year.
Black male privilege. You're pulling some old Negro male deception on us. You didn't really find white people who they failed and then they said, hey, don't even worry about it. We'll pay for you to take it again. Did that really happen with some white educators?
I know many of them.
Many. Mm-hmm. Context of white supremacy. Another black male with us, Dr. Antione D. Tomlin. Man. Black male privilege. That's what they tell us. Your report, you talk about how Brown v. Board of Education factored into all of this. And just to give folks the kind of double whammy on this one, it reminded me, we've been here for 14 years. We've covered this topic from a number of different ways. Reminded me of Stuart Buck, who's actually a white man, his book, Acting White, The Ironic Legacy of Desegregation. He has a whole section, firings and demotions. Actually, the main thrust of this book is that the whole concept, acting white, is one of the products of so-called desegregation, which was a failure. But either way, that you didn't really hear this term being said in terms of associating brain power and intellect. You did not really hear that being exclusively associated with being classified as white, because you had black teachers. You would see a black educator teaching the class and what have you. So you would not think, oh, that's a white thing to be reading or studying. That's kind of the main theme of Stuart Buck's book, Acting White. But he does have one section, firings and demotions, one of the lawsuits that led to the Brown v. Board of Education decisions was filed in Topeka, Kansas. But few today recall that teachers in Topeka were threatened with firing in the lawsuit Brown v. Board of Education, if the Brown v. Board of Education was successful. National Public Radio has observed that over the next few years after Brown, more than 80% of Topeka's black teachers weren't allowed to teach in desegregated schools. This is just an anecdote from one town, to be sure. On a nationwide scale, it is difficult to determine how many black teachers may have lost their jobs or been demoted due to desegregation, even while overall numbers of black teachers increased. Anecdotes of firings or demotions are plentiful. Robert Hooker's 1971 report for the Race Relations Information Center, I bet that was run by a lot of black people like Al Sharpton, noted that the demotion of black principals and teachers is more prevalent than outright dismissals. Examples include relieving former department heads of their titles, sending high school teachers to elementary classrooms, assigning teachers to subjects outside their expertise, and making black teachers into co-teachers or teacher's aides or even hall monitors. Nonetheless, Hooker documented numerous cases of dismissals, up to 2,000 in Alabama, more than 200 in Arkansas, go Bill Clinton, several hundred in Florida, and so forth. I will stop there, but that is a significant component in Stuart Buck's Acting White, which again, where he says, because they snatched so many black teachers away, and you don't see as many, so you kind of think, hey, only white people are smart. Gee, I certainly never, ever, ever see a black male teacher, less than 2%. Skipping back to the dissertation, Dr. Tomlin, he writes about all this. In Brown v. Board of Education, white students were enticed with camping and ski trips to attend a school in a predominantly black community. While the trips were open to all, black students largely could not attend because they did not already own the necessary equipment to experience the trips. Eventually, the trips were not enough to keep the white students. Enrollment dropped, and the school was quickly closed, forcing the black students to be bused to schools in predominantly white communities, and suspensions, dropouts, and expulsions continued to rise for black students. At the same time, the desegregation plan provided magnet programs and extended daycare, which whites were able to take advantage of. Thus, Ladson, Billings, and Tate noted a model desegregation program becomes defined as one that ensures that whites are happy and do not leave the system altogether, regardless of whether African Americans and other students of color achieve or remain. You could just add black educators into that as well. Can you kind of describe how this, because this is kind of a historical foundation for why the academic system looks the way it does in the U.S. today, the whole desegregation, both the impact on black students and, as I said, about black educators being kicked out of that whole system altogether.
You know, for me, what it comes down to is equity, right? And there's a lot of talk and a lot of movement around diversity, equity, inclusion, and now I think we are starting to see a lot of work around anti-racism. And that's what it comes down to for me as well, right? What are we doing to actively shift and change, right? So that, yes, we get to equitable outcomes, but that anti-racist piece is so important, because if we don't put action behind whatever it is that we're doing, we're not going to get anywhere. And a few years ago, I said, I was on a panel and I said, you know, most institutions, K through 12 and higher ed right now, I use the analogy of marriage and wedding, right? I said, most institutions are ready for a wedding, right, when it comes to DEIA work, right? They want the bells and whistles. They want to show up. They want to take credit for, but they're not ready for the marriage and the hard work that comes along with what you said you were going to commit to. And how do you see it through and you follow through in order, in this case, to support especially Black and Brown students? Right. So we want all of the accolades. We want to be nationally recognized for, right, an initiative that we slapped our name on. But once we get the photograph, right, once we get the award, we're not continuing to do the work that it takes in order to continue to create a shift that's going to be necessary and impactful for, again, especially Black and Brown students. And so until we make that shift, and until we lean into that, really, and really think about what does it take in order for all students to be able to be in a space that is going to allow for them to be successful, right? Again, I use the word stuck. We're stuck, right? And when we think about what we need to do in order to do the work, right, there's some tough love, there's some tough things that we need to unpack and work through in order to move forward. Right? Many folks, especially in education, are just still not ready to do the work that we need, right, for whatever reason, right? And so I think it's important for us to acknowledge, sure, we can continue to point and say, oh, well, it's this and it's that. And we need all folks to take accountability for, right? So again, how long, right, do we need to continue to talk about things without the action? And so bringing that anti-racism piece back in now, right, because education for a long time, and in many ways now, is still an anti-Black space, right? We need to acknowledge and name that too, right? And so I'm expected as a Black male to show up and to do these things that are going to make me successful, right, i.e. getting the education. But I'm supposed to do it in a space that doesn't welcome and celebrate and value me and who I am and what I bring to it, right? And so, of course, that's an issue, but and it's always been an issue, and it's still an issue, right? But I'm supposed to just show up and figure it out and do what I need to do. So what I need, especially my white colleagues and counterparts to know is, right, this is very much still an anti-Black space. So what do we need to do in order to continue doing the work, to commit to creating that shift that's going to allow me to show up, people who look like me to show up, to be all of who they are, and going back to what I said earlier, to stand in their Blackness, to be bold and confident, right, and to stand in their brilliance. I shouldn't have to dim my light or be worried about what might happen if I show up as just who I am.
I see some of the folks who dialed in with a hand up. If you have a question, the number is 605-313-5164. The code 564-943-pound. Press star 61 if you have a question for Dr. Tomlin. Star 61. Dr. Tomlin, do you think with regards to individuals classified as white, do you think the problem is that they are not aware of the anti-Black white supremacist nature of the academic setting in this part of the world and really worldwide? Or do you think individuals classified as white are dedicated to maintaining an anti-Black space system of white supremacy racism in education?
That's a good question. I think it's a mix, right, of a few different things, all of the above. Some of it is a lack of awareness, and some of it is a willingness to be ignorant. And I mean that in the true sense. And I say that because I had a book that I released earlier around student affairs practitioners in higher education, and I called it Working While Black, The Untold Stories of Student Affairs Practitioners. And one of the things that I'm doing to support our DEIA initiatives at my college is doing professional development workshops for my colleagues. And this particular workshop is called Supporting Black Staff. And so folks from all over the college can come, and they just learn. I do a panel style kind of workshop. It's an hour and a half, and they learn what it really means to be Black and work in higher education. They also learn, what does it look like for you to actually show up in a genuine space and be an ally to support me? And what's not helpful, even though maybe you think it's helpful, right? And I say that to share, oftentimes, most of the white folks in the room are folks that I work with, right, who I value the working relationship, and I feel that that's mutual. All that to say, the folks who need to be in the room are not in the room, right? And so it ends up being this thing of not necessarily preaching to the choir, because I do think all of my colleagues take something away from the panel that I invite to do the workshop with me. And I'm just wondering, how might we reach folks who really need to hear this information if they're not in the room, right? And so I've done a lot of things to kind of address some of that too. But that's the willful ignorance that I'm talking about, right? Like you intentionally not showing up to this because you are set in a certain mindset or way of thinking, and you're not ready to have the seed planted, right? So it's not that I feel like I'm on a personal mission to change everybody's mind, right? But I do truly believe that if I plant the seed, eventually it's going to grow and transformation will happen in some way, even if I never get to see it.
Context of white supremacy. For our listeners, we hear that almost every time we have a guest on the program, that white people, some of them are ignorant or willful ignorant. That's very common phrasing, willful ignorance. I quote Mr. Neely Fuller Jr., individuals classified as white cannot be ignorant about racism, white supremacy. If they are, they will get in trouble with other white people. In fact, I'm going to read. This is a great, I had to change my highlight color for this one, Dr. Tomlin. This is on page 140 of your dissertation, When They See Us, Narratives of Black Male Teachers. What did you say that warranted a new color highlighter? When the Black male teachers in the study did voice their concerns to colleagues or administrators about how these school-based factors impacted their experiences as educators, very little was done to resolve or improve the issues due to the institutionalized racist structures that have been perpetuated by the teaching profession. That's one, if it was me, if I was on the edit team, that would have had to be switched to perpetuated by white women, because that's the bulk of who we're talking about here. The educational system was not made for the success of people of color, particularly not Black boys or men. The concept of Afro-pessimism speaks to the notion that Black people remain something to be possessed and who consequently cannot live, move, or breathe for themselves. Applying this concept to Black male teachers can explain why they do not get to make suggestions about their experiences as teachers and why their suggestions or concerns are not taken seriously. The concept of Afro-pessimism is beneficial in thinking about the situations of these Black male teachers as they stay in a profession that may be killing them socially, as the stressors and tensions of being a Black male teacher are major and are deeply rooted in this country's white-centered history and foundation of our educational systems. These factors cannot be changed easily, and Black male teachers are still struggling to be seen as an equal while being treated inequitably. While they deal with the bias, frustration, and underappreciation in their own ways, their careers are being subtly but nevertheless significantly undermined both intellectually and professionally. Dr. Tomlin had to use a different highlighter, all of that to say, That does not sound like ignorance to me. If they come and report to you, these are the problems, and I'm ignored and not taken seriously. Did I misread Dr. Tomlin?
No. You got it spot on. And I think this also goes back to what we were talking about earlier in terms of black male teachers also having those experiences of sexual harassment, right? The other piece is, if I bring that, I'm not going to be taken seriously, right? So same thing here, right? When I step outside of the narrative that you have written and pushed me into, when I step outside of the box that you wanted to kind of package me in, no, that's not your job, right? So you stay in this lane, right, where you are, right, what we need you to be, what we need you to look like, what we need you to sound like, and that's all we need, right? We don't need you to bring anything else to our attention, especially not about your experience, because at the end of the day, we don't care, right? That's exactly what some of my participants share and what was coming up for them as we talked about many of their lived experiences as black men who teach.
Dedication, that is my definition. It's not unawares, willful ignorance. It is dedication to white supremacy, racism. Let us see. Folks who dialed in with a hand up. Retired firefighter in Florida. If you have a question for Dr. Tomlin, you should be with us.
Greetings to the doctor. Greetings to everyone. I went through grade school in the 60s and the 70s. There was only one bad example of a black male teacher during that time. But that don't have anything to do with the question I'm asked. The question that I have is this. I deal with a lot of children in what is called mentoring programs. And this first part, you probably all quite aware of, when you ask black male children in this part of the world about, you know, the proverbial question, what you want to be when you grow up, or, you know, what type of profession you would like to pursue, you get a lot of interest into the people activity of entertainment, especially sports, football, professional football, and basketball. As you know, there certainly is a lot more things that they should be interested in terms of their time and energy. What suggestions you have that one can interject into these male children about having some other interests other than sports, as far as what they want to be, as far as a profession, or when they become of adult age? Thank you.
One, thank you for your service, retired firefighter. Two, I see this a lot, where especially students of color and black male students will say, well, this is the goal, right? This is what I want to be when I grow up, right? And oftentimes, very similar to what you shared, it is, right, in entertainment or athletics. And I have the conversations that need to be had with all of my students around, what does it look like for you to reach your goals, right? And quite frankly, also, what does plan B, C, D, E, F look like, right? So it's not that I go in and I'm like, nope, you're not going to the league, right? Because in fact, I'm like, please do, and don't forget about the small people who just help support you, right? And I want to be very realistic about what are all of the things that you want to accomplish, right? Because even if you make it to the league or you make it to entertainment, that's not a profession that'll last a lifetime. Maybe no profession lasts a lifetime, right? And many of those opportunities when you're in a profession like that are only for a certain amount of time, right? And so then we talk about that too. What does it look like after you finish? When you retire from the league, what else do you want to do, right? And how do we make sure that we support you and setting you up to get the transferable skills that you are going to need in order to still be successful, right? So for me, it's not a nope, you'll never do that, because I think especially our Black and Brown students have had enough of that, right? You can't, you won't, right? You'll never. And for me as well, right, I was supposed to be another number, another dropout, right, in my family, but also the families in the neighborhood who look like me, right? And if all I heard was, you can't, you won't, you never, right? I never had the folks who were like, well, how could things be otherwise, right? What else is possible for you? What do you need in order to be supported? How do you need me to show up? I think that's the key question that oftentimes we forget, just as people and as humans in general, what is it that you need from me, right? And so asking that simple question of the students may, or the folks that you interact with in the program may also be beneficial if you haven't already started asking that, right? And then get in the habit of continually asking that. I ask my students that almost every class, right? What do you need from me? In addition to teaching, I'm also a certified and trained life coach. And so one of the questions or the approaches that I take is we need to clear, right? So when we walk into the space, what do you need to hold a little more lightly? Right? What do you need to leave at the door if you can? Right? What do you need to sit beside you? Because it's so important right now that if you don't sit it beside you, you're not going to be here and you're going to be distracted anyway. Right? So some of those questions also, I think, dig a little deeper for us to be able to just say, hey, how do you need me to show up?
Okay. That makes sense. That's a good strategy to utilize, and especially the part that you mentioned about don't come right out and say what that person what their dream is. That's not going to happen. Although you know,
sir,
I do
question,
know that
question lane, please.
No, I was just acknowledging what he was saying was what is a good idea. That's all I was doing.
Right on. Did you have another question?
No, sir.
Right on. Let's see. Our caller, much obliged, retired firefighter in Florida. Irie, did you have a question for Dr. Tomlin? You should be with us.
Good evening. Thank you, Gus, for the show. And Dr. Tomlin, thank you for attending. I didn't catch everything. I just dropped in. But when I heard it was about, you know, education, I wanted to ask you a couple questions. And, well, not a couple. Three questions. Thank you. I didn't catch this. Have you taught in, what is it, like primary school, secondary, meaning middle school or high school ever?
No. Good question. No, I have not. So I have not been a K-12 educator in a full-time capacity. So I have directed summer bridge programs for high schools in Baltimore City, in which I also taught in those summer bridge programs. But full-time, in a full-time capacity in academic year, I have not.
Okay. All righty. So as best as you can, I do have these questions. If you feel you can give an answer, I appreciate it. If not, I understand. I've been a substitute teacher for over a decade. And I think it would be more constructive for most classes to be co-taught with a male and female. And I'm assuming that they're both non-white Black people. Like that would be my most optimal condition for non-white children, particularly Black in the classrooms I've been in. It's been majority Black kids. What do you think of that? That thought.
Yeah, I think that's an interesting concept. I will say, even at the college level, depending on the course and in the program, I have co-taught. And almost always I've co-taught with other Black folks. And so I have maybe some experience of that model at the higher education level. And I absolutely enjoyed it, whether it was with a Black woman or a Black male, or a person who doesn't identify as male or female, right? I've had a really, really great experience, because what I found is that we balance each other out in a lot of different ways. And so you can ask one of my really great colleagues and friends to this day, he remembers this experience. We actually were teaching the college prep course, so similar to like freshman seminar for college students, in the high school. And so it was a summer course. We went into one of the Baltimore City high schools for specifically that Baltimore City public school students. And he said, they absolutely loved you because I like to have a good time, right? I like to have a good time. I like to get man cut up with my students too, because they need to see that I'm a person, right? So despite all of the credentials, despite all of the experience, I like to have a good time. And I always say, if I'm not having fun, you're not having fun, then what are we doing, right? And my colleague said, but you would have such a great time with them and still like have the tough conversation of like, you need to get your act together because you're failing the course, right? And two things can be true. I can have a good time, but I build that rapport so that when I need to kind of jack them up, right? Now, I'm not going to physically jack them up, right? But when I need to have that tough conversation of what's happening, that they receive it, right? Because it is coming from care, but I do need to be firm in those moments to say what's happening. So to answer your question, I think that's an interesting model. Of course, it's going to take some resources and funding, right, which we talked about a little bit earlier. Some school districts just, they don't want to put their money where their mouth is. But I do think it's an interesting concept that could work. And I do think that students will benefit from that. So, yeah. I'm excited to even reimagine, like, what does that look like of co-teaching, and what does it look like when you put two folks of color in front of the classroom to support students who look like them?
Okay. Thank you. Mm-hmm. What classes would be most constructive? Which subjects would be most constructive for a Black male teacher to lead, like customarily or every time, in a classroom setting?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So my biased answer is English, right? Because that's my background. And I think all of them, mm-hmm. to be honest, right? So again, not putting all the work on Black male teachers, but I think wherever they land, it's important for them to show up and be who they are in that space, right? And so my research talks a little bit about this idea that my Black male teacher participants who were not in a core subject, and for my research, I called the core subject the core four. It was like social studies, English, math, and science, right? I had teachers who were not in the core subject, and their course was, or discipline was determined to be an elective, right? So photography and music and all of the like, right? They felt less valued and less included because they didn't have a standardized test attached to, right, the discipline or the subject, and so they didn't get as much support. And so I also wonder, what does it look like for our teachers who teach in what we call elective courses, right? So it's not necessarily the course that you need to take in order to get your high school diploma, right? It's one of the courses that you pick from, right? When we look at those teachers, how are they also being supported? How do we show up to make sure that they get what they need as well? And so I think absolutely all the courses, but especially courses that are not surrounded around the core for that students need to take in order to get that high school diploma will be helpful for our Black male teachers to stand in and to shine in as well.
Okay. Just one more question. Have you ever been or experienced anti-Blackness from a non-white person for any non-white person? Because I'm just asking because you said you wouldn't mind co-teaching with someone else of color, which I'm taking to mean not white, but I know from my experience many times I personally have been mistreated by non-white, non-black people, and I'm wondering, have you had that experience ever?
Yeah. Every day, right? I move through the world as a black male, so every day. And most times also during the workday in my profession, right? That's also why I knew that I needed to get a terminal degree. So I went and I did the PhD, yes, because it was for me, and sure, it's nice, right, to say I'm Dr. Tomlin. But to be honest, I knew I was going to stay in education, and folks who don't look like me were never going to take me serious if I didn't have the doctor in front of my name, right, or the initials behind my name, however you want to write it, right? And so that felt like something that I needed to do in order to even just be taken more seriously, right? So similar to what we were talking about earlier, black men and black male teachers bringing their challenges to administration or talking about the experiences and then them being dismissed, similar to me, especially early on. I started teaching really early in higher education. I was just 21 when I started. And you can imagine, right, like even in higher education, most of the population of faculty is still white women, right? And so I had a few experiences early on, especially with white women and my age and me not looking or, well, I'm sorry, you look like a student and all of these things, right, to undermine, right, what I was doing, to undermine my expertise, to undermine all of the things that I brought to the space, right? And I'm like, sure, I was super young, but I still had the experience, right? And so that's the part that you try to take away from me, the experience of things. So, yes, every day. And it's about, for me, how I show up, right? But also the energy that I bring, even when it feels like nasty, negative energy around me, right? I don't allow that, in many cases, to overwhelm and consume me, right? So that's not to say that sometimes I don't have a day where I'm like, ooh, if I, right, didn't need my job, right, I'm going to war. And I try to hold things a little more lightly, right? And then to plant those seeds when I need to of what does transformation look like?
Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Much obliged, Irie in Louisiana. Go Tigers. Henry in Chicago. Did you have commentary for Dr. Tomlin? You should be with us.
greetings, Gus, and greetings, Dr. Tomlin. Great discussion on underrepresentation of black males in education. I have two questions. So earlier in the program, Dr. Tommy Curry was referenced. What's interesting is today he attached an article on his Twitter account called "School Counseling Joins the List of Targeted Professions, Leaving Students Even More Vulnerable," and it's from the diverseeducation.com website, and it talks about how during the COVID-19 pandemic, a lot of students, especially Black students, have been severely impacted mentally by the pandemic because of the remote learning process. And it talks about how a lot of these students, a lot of the schools where Black students attend had a severe reduction in counselors and psychologists. And so my first question is, you talked about the underrepresentation of classroom teachers. How underrepresented is the support systems like counselors and psychologists are, as far as Black males?
That's a good question. I will share with you that I don't have the actual statistics and data, so I'm speaking from my own experiences of what I see. And many times what I've found, especially in personal interactions and spaces where I occupy, is I've seen more Black women who are in those counselor roles, less black men. And I, to be honest, I don't know what, right, what the reason is for that or how we can dig into, like, what's happening behind the scenes. And it could be that, you know, black men are in the profession because I know a lot of therapists and psychologists. However, they're not in the school system. Now, I also will say some of this, right, comes down to also finances and income and salary, right? So if, to be honest, this is my thinking, right? If I'm a certified black therapist, right, and I can do counseling, if I open up my own practice, I can make a certain amount of money. And if I go and do my work in the school system, I maybe make half of what I could be making. I think that's important too, right? And so thinking that that's one thing that I think maybe contributing to this. It's not the only thing, but I think it's about how we, one, recruit and retain, but also what are we paying, right? Are we paying our black counselors and therapists for their expertise? And then what does that look like?
Okay. One more question, if I'm allowed.
Mm-hmm.
I, in my undergrad, had took some actual educational courses as a kind of like a backup, you know, and I thought about being a classroom teacher at one point. But I noticed, too, now that I think about it, that the teachers that I had in my educational courses were female, whether they be black or white. But I did not see any male, black male professors who taught, you know, educational courses. How underrepresented is that when you talk about, you know, teachers who go through, you know, teacher training in these colleges, and do they see any black males actually teaching these courses?
That this is a good question. So I will share with you, I teach in a few different departments. So while my home department is developmental English, I also teach in the education department. And the course that I usually teach is the culturally responsive instruction course, right? And what I will say is I have seen that the population of K through 12 teachers almost identically reflects the population of education professors, right? Now, I actually don't think that's a shock. It makes total sense to me, right? Like, if black, especially black males, are not staying in the teaching profession, of course, right, they don't have some of the experience that will qualify them to teach in a teacher education program, right? Many, when you think about higher education, many institutions want you to have 2 to 3 years of experience in addition to whatever, right? So if that black male teacher didn't teach for at least 2 or 3 years, they're not even qualified to apply for a teaching position at a college or institution, right? And so you see all of the white women who taught, they transition into higher education and they teach teachers in training, right, what they learned and what they did when they were in the classroom. So that's also, I think, why we don't see that many black male faculty members. It's because, especially with teacher education programs, they want you to have a certain number of years of experience or teaching in the classroom, right? And so because many black males don't have that, they're not even called upon to step into the higher ed institution space.
Thank you, Dr. Tomlin, and thank you, Gus. I'll meet my line.
Mm-hmm.
Much obliged. So glad, since I borrowed a little bit of his shared commentary for our introduction that I set up, a young academic actually hopped on the line, one of our black male educators. Make sure, did I tell a fib, as they say? Was I in here being deceitful in saying that I believe young academic already shared? He gave us two different about white women sexual harassing him, even undergrad, saying, man,
seemed like she was trying to hook me up with a white woman, and me rejecting it made my whole undergrad trying to get my master's and finish up my education degree made it difficult. Well, did I remember that incorrectly?
No, you did not. Absolutely true, sir. Thank you for the program.
For sure.
Greetings, Gus and Dr. Tomlin. Can I be heard?
Yes, sir. We can hear you.
All right. From experience, high test scores are commonly assumed to have a strong correlation with teacher effectiveness and student outcomes. High stakes test scores are planned obsolescence used to block entry and eliminate black male teachers or force them in areas with less resources. It is used to judge teacher worth by how much test scores improve, which in turn justifies white access to better resources and causes competition in education in which blacks are forced to compete for space and access to opportunity. Dr. Tomlin, are you familiar with new eugenics? Well, the link between new eugenics and standardized testing, what are your thoughts?
So bottom line, and I alluded to this a little bit earlier with the praxis. To be honest, I think we just need to throw them out, right? The standardized test, especially because in some of my research, I shared that many of the black teachers who I studied did not come through traditional teacher education programs. So that's one. Two, that's not even to say that a traditional teacher education program is going to prepare you in order to do what you need to do on a standardized test, right? And so I do truly think that we still are holding too much weight to these standardized tests of this is what success will look like, or if you perform in this way on a standardized test, success will follow, right? And so I, to be honest, I don't think that that's the truth. And again, going back to even some of the teachers who I interviewed in this study that we're talking about, at the time were not certified, right? And so amazing teachers, I got to talk a lot about their experiences and how they support students. and they weren't certified, right? So I'm not going to say that you don't need to be certified. That's not where I'm going. But I do think that we need to figure out what are some alternative ways in which we can say yes, right? You did whatever the thing was, right, in order to be certified and recognized by the state. But I don't think that performing well on a standardized test will automatically say this is what you need in order to be deemed successful in the classroom.
Thank you for your response. Mm-hmm. That's all the questions I have for now. Go.
Much obliged, young academic. Star 6-1, if other folks have questions they would like to ask Dr. Tomlin. Let's see, getting back to the report. Let's see, this you talk about, again, less than 2% of the educators in this part of the world, black males, even though you growing number of the student population, non-white students, but less than 2% are black males. You and your report talk about this paltry number as tokenism, and this is on page 43. You write, Brandel conclude, although it is true that almost that all minorities experience some level of tokenism, black males and black females experience the greatest levels of tokenism. Overall, black males and females also experienced more visibility, isolation, and assimilation, as Cantor would describe it. This is from this concept taken from Rosebeth Moss Cantor. She is the Ernest L. Arbuckle Professor of Business Administration at Harvard Business School. Whew, talk about pedigree. This is her from her report, some effects of proportions of group life, skewed sex ratios, and responses to token women. This is published way back in 1977, almost 50 years ago. This concept of tokenism from Rose Beth Moss Cantor, why did you feel that would apply to what black males are experiencing in the classroom here?
I use that as the undertone. The theory that I use as kind of like the overarching to position the study was actually, black critical theory and thinking about what does it look like to be in anti-black space, i.e. education. And I pulled in Cantor's theory of tokenism because that's where my mind went, right? Like, what are these black male teachers experiencing? And are they put into positions similar to what we talked about earlier, the black Superman, right? Are they put into positions that force them to perform in a certain way? And for that, then are they glorified when they perform in that way, right? So the school police or the disciplinarians, right? The mentor or the role model. So there were some positions that on first thought were not negative, right? Or they don't sound like they have negative connotations attached to them, right? So for instance, the caring black male mentor role model, right? That's absolutely a good thing. However, what happens to the black male teachers who didn't sign up for that, right? Or who felt like, okay, I'm forced or pushed into this when I should be mentoring all students, not just students who look like me, right? So when we pull in that idea of tokenism, you're going to show up, you're going to do exactly what it is that we hired you to do, right? And oftentimes what I found, especially in this study, is the black males were not hired to teach, actually, right? So they had the title in their contract as teacher, but they were hired for very specific reasons. And then we lean into that idea of tokenism, right? You're going to be the black token here. So you're going to be, right, the one person that we need in order to check the demographics and diversity box, right? So similar to my experiences now, in terms of English and developmental English, we have a total of 27 full-time faculty, right? There are only two of us who are black male in that department. And we're the only two black people in that department. So when we think of, I actively fight again, are you asking me to do something because I'm black, right? Or are you asking me because of my expertise? And again, going back to earlier, two things can be true at the same time, but what I won't do is stand in the space because I'm black, right? For your benefit. I'm going to stand in the space because I'm black, because I love being black, right? And I'm going to show up and show out, but I'm not going to stand in the space because you feel like you need me to based on what I look like.
Fascinating. And you, make sure for listeners, you ground your dissertation very early on in explaining critical race theory and even black critical race theory and saying that it is important to analyze this problem not through the lens of color blindness, but kind of being upfront that racism, white supremacy, or white supremacy is not used, but racism is the focal point, the foundation of this problem, and that needs to be at the forefront of our analysis of why we have this dearth of black male educators. That's, as you stated, very explicitly stated. You even reference some of the founders of critical race theory, Derek Bell, Faces at the Bottom of the Well, and Kimberly Crenshaw, Angela Harris, Patricia Williams, quite a few folks who are credited, and it's others, but I mean, you list quite a few folks who are credited with being kind of the founders of this concept, critical race theory. Many of these folks, non-white people, black people, Derek Bell, Kimberly Crenshaw, Dorothy Roberts, Patricia Williams, etc. The concept of
tokenism with this. I looked at it, but I guess it was a few things, I guess. One, when I went to get more information, because I had never heard of Rosebeth Moss Cantor, when I saw her faculty page at the Harvard Business School, and I said, man, like, when we use the concept of gender, 99.9% of the time, we are not talking about males. We are definitely not talking about black males. Cantor, when she concocted this theory, I could be totally in error, but I looked over her faculty page. I didn't see any reference to racism, white supremacy, mm-hmm. race, nothing. Lots of sexism, gender, all of that. Invariably, when white women start talking about gender and problems that are impacting women anywhere in the world, just like they say, the man, the woman is white. I suspect she wasn't even talking about non-white females when she authored this report. When I read, like, when I skip down, I'm skipping a little bit further down in your report. This is on page 139 at the top. You write, black male teachers have unique lived experiences of social suffering and resistance in which their existence is a despised thing in itself. It is clear that black male teachers are not being respected and honored for their intellectual abilities in the same way as their non-black colleagues. Rather, white teachers and administrators, the dominant group, include black male teachers, the tokens, yet do so in ways that still hold on to their generalizations about the stereotypes and assumptions of how black male teachers should operate in the profession. As Cantor notes, 1977, as I said, it is oftentimes easier for tokens to sit in these roles than to fight them. Indeed, some of the black male teachers in this study sit in these roles and accept them, as mentioned above, rather than fight the situation without the support that comes from being of the numerical majority. In turn, this role entrapment consequently provides a certain level of self-distortion to black male teachers who may begin to accept their situation as normal and unproblematic, even as they can identify some of the challenges it causes for themselves in their personal and professional lives. I think that's such an important point for so many. This was another one where I had to switch up my highlighter color. Bing, three different colors. This was another one. I said, man, by this point, because this is way later in the report, this is we're getting on the home. Yet we are. This is like the home stretch of the report here. And it's, by this point, I knew this is a crotchety old white woman. And I'm not saying that to like me. She's at Harvard, man. But she has nothing. Nothing in her scholarship addresses black males, black people in general. I'm submitting. I don't even think she cares about non-white females, but whatever. She is not at all focused on her concept. Nothing. It is about white women. Like, oh, man. Like, if my thinking was, if we swap this out with black misandry, bang. Now we're getting for the totality of this. It's not just the bottleneck of black male educators, black students. All of this, black misandry is such a huge component of white supremacy, racism, and the totality of the black male experience, as opposed to this concept from 50 years ago from a white woman who does not care about black people at all while she's sitting up in the posh ivory towers of Howard at all. Go Howard, HBCUs in general, but at Harvard, not writing about our plight as black males at all. Am I making sense, Dr. Tomlin?
Mm-hmm. You are. And that's exactly why, right, I decided to pull that in, but it was the sub-theory, right? Because her original work didn't do what I needed it to do. Right. And so while the concept was important for me to tease out, that's exactly why it ended up being a sub-theory and not the overarching theory that situates all of my research for exactly what you just said.
Okay, I don't feel so crazy now. Okay. And again, Dr. Tommy J. Curry, the man not race, class, genre, and the dilemmas of black manhood. Just that concept, Black Misandry, because sexism is in this report. But I say when they're talking about sexism, they always mean females. They never mean black males. Even when they say if they're going to say patriarchy, it should be white male patriarchy every time. Make it explicit, because black males are not in positions of power. At all. They know this. Everybody knows this. Nobody needs a seminar on this. Theory should reflect that black misandry. The fact that people don't even know that term doesn't get used, when that's exactly what this is. Specific, deliberate, willful. We're going to keep these black males. They're going to be all of them. They need developmental English, and they're going to fail it even if they do take it. Even if they do pass, they'll fail when they get to the regular English class. Black teeth, they're going to fail the praxis. They pass it. We got other things lined up for them. We'll sexually harass them and dare to report. All of that is white supremacy, racism, but it's specific black misandry that doesn't get talked about. In fact, as Dr. Curry says, even when you try to address it, get out of here. That's ridiculous. I was even thinking, as I went back to look at the directors, like, man, I could see where if you have directors, they would not say, hey, we could update this, as opposed to we got to get this crotchety white woman from the 1970s, Dr. Curry, 2017, like brand new on a bench. No. And he said, as a black male, his scholarship is ridiculed. He got the doctorate and is still ridiculed. Get on out of here. Black, no count raping black. He said he gets cut. They say you are caping for no count, lazy raping black males. That's exactly what you're doing. He said, but I got the data. I went to research. I wrote a whole book of that. Get out of here. We don't want to. Super. That's one of the most important books that I've read in terms of just how important. That's where we can talk about females being mistreated and sexism all day. Everybody knows misogyny and sexism. Nobody. Black misandry? Even though that's exactly what we're talking about all the time. Another plug. Dr. Tommy J. Curry, the man not race, class, genre, and the dilemmas of black manhood. This one. I thought exactly of Young Academic. I thought of him so many times as I went through to read this. I'm backing up a little. I had to hop around all over the place in this reply. I'm so glad I read this, because if I didn't, I would have been super confused. Backing up to 113. Boop, 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 boop. Oh, man, he has so many from the different black males that he talks to in the Baltimore area, school teachers that he talks to. So I'm backing up to 113, middle paragraph. Dr. Travis Bristow, former guest and mentor, called for more empirical research to explore how black male teachers believe fellow colleagues and administrators position them in their school settings. In their study, as noted earlier, Bristow and mentor found that black male teachers perceived that their peers and school administrators positioned them to serve primarily as de facto disciplinarians. The findings in the study contradict Bristow and Mentor in some regards. For one, Greenleaf, Moses, Mack, and Ernest, these are four black males in the study, all express the value they feel their colleagues find in them as leaders, despite the fact that Moses and Ernest also felt that they were at times called upon for behavioral management. While black male teachers have their challenges within the profession, they also have some colleagues who admire and respect them as people and as experts in the profession. A possibility is that these admirations are being presented as respect for the men's leadership, but leadership, in quotes, is masking something else. Black men could be seeing themselves being perceived as leaders, while other colleagues and administrators may be using the term leader to manipulate them into other roles like mediator, problem solver, or disciplinarian. That should have been worthy of a fourth different highlighter. I guess I was being a little bit of a shiftless Negro right there. Ooh-wee. That is super sophisticated analysis there. Can you give us some more detail, Dr. Tomlin?
Yeah, so when I talk to many of the black male teachers, that very thing came out. And it was, so it was done in a way, right? Leader, right? We're going to give you a promotion, or we're going to change your title, or whatever the case is. It was done in a way that was leaning into what should have been maybe celebrations, right? And so when you do that, you mask what you're actually doing. You hide the agenda behind, right? So when the school system comes to me and says, okay, we want you to do fill in the blank, right? And we're going to maybe give you a stipend for it, or we're going to recognize you in this way, right? It's leader in quotes, right? However, it really is us, you know, backhandedly kind of still pushing you to do the thing that we want you to do, right? And so that's why I also shared that I'm very intentional about who I am as a black male educator, right? And showing up in spaces and doing at my institution and at other places as well. I'm going to show up and I'm going to stand in my blackness, but I'm not showing up because I'm black to benefit you, right? And so you see this interesting dynamic of many of the black male teachers in the study kind of figuring that out and connecting the dots. And it was something very interesting to see and to learn from, because many of them had at some point, whether it was before the study, whether it was after the study, they had these aha moments of like, wait a minute, right? That's exactly what I actually don't want to do, right? But you kind of glorified it and you slapped leader on it in some way, shape, or form. And maybe you dangled a little stipend, right? Because I already don't make anything. And, you know, and really it was a plan all the while for the school system and administrators to put you in the place of what, right? So for instance, director of mentoring, right? Sure, that sounds great, right? I get to take on a leadership role. And you only ask me because I'm a black male teacher, right? And it's not that many of me, especially at this school. And so when we think about things like that, right, it's like did you give it to me because of, again, my expertise and what I bring, or did you give it to me or push me into this because of what I look like?
Brag on you. You're black Superman. You can do it. You can do everything. It's a bird. It's a plane. It's super Negro. It can do all things with no raise. Young academic, thought of himself. But you do such an amazing job in saying that I deliberately am centering the voices of these black male teachers, because, and I think Dr. Curry talks about this too, and saying that so many times, even when we are pretending frequently, that's what I think it is, and say, oh, I care so much about the black male, and, you know, we got to address the needs of the black male. When we, many folks are doing this, even then, black males' voices are muted. We are citing Cantor and other white people or non-black people or even non-black males to speak to their experience. And you center black males specifically. This is, let me get page 84 of your dissertation. So this is some of the black males that you talked to in the report. You say, while talking to Moses, I asked him if he ever felt undermined in the workplace due to being a black male teacher. He laughed and immediately said, absolutely. He went on to share, being a black male, it's presumed that I am willing, able, and agreeable to taking those students that make poor decisions or have unacceptable or negative behavior. As a black male, we tend to get those all the time. Moses went on to explain that a major part of his job entails dealing with student behavioral problems. He noted, as a black male, we are not even considered for a gifted and talented population, we are considered for management, meaning behavioral management. Moses' experience of feeling like he has to be the governor of unacceptable or negative behavior goes back to the notion of black men having to take on the role of disciplinarian to bring order to the schoolhouse. In these roles, black male teachers have the potential to burn out as they are solely the ones expected to take on this challenging and often thankless role. I'm just skipping forward a little bit. So this is a different participant in the study. Feeling less than in comparison to other colleagues is a concept that Ernest is not new to and was not afraid to air at all. Ernest shared that there are some progressive thinking people that work for Baltimore City Schools, and he has done some work with other administrators as well. These experiences have given him some insight into how they operate. With that, he told me the mere fact that I have to find insight to how they operate, it also speaks to the lack of professionalism within the entire system, because it's that same cronyism, and you gotta know somebody to get somewhere in the system. Somebody has to be your friend, and it's sad because the bottom line is, if I'm professional enough and I have the education and the willingness to do the job and I'm qualified for the job, why not give me a try? Ernest additionally told me because he is not a part of a clique, Greek organization, or new millennial teachers group, he finds it very hard and isolating at times. He feels this way, especially when it comes to trying to move into different areas within education. Skipping down a little bit, I also asked Michael whether he felt he had autonomy or felt respected intellectually. He told me that he didn't and elaborated on situations in which his qualifications come into question. He began by explaining, "I think sometimes because I don't come off as aggressive in a lot of situations, a lot of staff could mistake my kindness for weakness." Michael was born and raised in the South and was taught to respect his elders. A part of this meant using ma'am and sir to anyone who was an elder. His colleagues would not see the value in Michael's use of manners and thought it was crazy. Further, Michael once joined a staff meeting to discuss the hallway guidelines and rules for students, and one of his white colleagues said, "I don't know if you're qualified. Are you qualified to be saying this?" Michael, at this point, had been teaching at the school for 4 years. Michael responded playfully back, "I don't know. Maybe I am." The colleague continued to lessen Michael's experience and input while supposedly joking, but Michael told me that it had gone too far and no longer felt like a joke. In response, Michael told me, "He was saying enough. I had to pause him for a second, and I was like, I want to get real for a second. My ego came into play to the point where I needed for him to shut up." At this moment, Michael expressed that they needed to take the hallway policies seriously, and he had a right to have a space in the conversation. The white colleague continued, "Look at you. You don't get mad. You don't get rowdy." So revealing about what it means to be white. Continuing, at that point, Michael decided to have a private conversation with the colleague after the meeting. They hashed things out peacefully. However, Michael sensed that he had to deal with something not related to his job because of the color of his skin is disturbing. While the white colleague may have not meant harm and may have been joking, his behavior was inappropriate during a professional meeting. The colleague's intention may not have been to silence or treat Michael as less than, but it nevertheless impacted Michael. Drawing upon his strength of character, Michael was able to hold his colleague accountable, which is what should be happening. Within the work of diversity, equity, and inclusion, the world of education, we must be thinking about intent versus impact and taking care of the impact of things said and done, even when there may have been a good-natured intent. We cannot tell people how to feel about something that impacted them. However, we can take care of the impact that resulted from the original force. This is one way we begin to move Black male teachers forward from the periphery to a space of inclusion. I will stop there. There are a plethora of rich stories in this text from these Black male teachers, but wow, those two right there, in terms of being undermined in a workspace, man, just, I guess, too, thank you for indulging me, but why did you think it was so important to center? Because you have lots of these rich, like, you can't include everything, the rapes and all that, too, harassment, but why did you think it was so important to include stories like what I just read from Michael and Ernest?
So when I decided that this is the project that I was going to do, and I was thinking through what's the best way, right? Similar to what you shared, there's so much research on the experiences of Black male teachers not told by Black males. And so it was so important for me really to lean into the words, right? The stories, the actual listenings and hearings from Black male teachers. And so that's what that this project really was for me. It was an opportunity to get to know these participants and to be able to really use this dissertation as a platform for them to tell their stories, right? So early on, you're right, I made it a point. It wasn't about me telling their story for my benefit. Sure, like I got the degree from it, but it really became, what do I need to do in order to make sure that these Black males are going to be able to share their story the way they need to share their story for anyone who picks it up to really feel that they can get a good sense of the experiences from their voice, their perspective, their tone. And so when I was going through and writing up everything, there was a lot of back and forth about, all right, did I capture this right? Because even with, right, I transcribed all of my interviews with the participants, so I had the exact words, but it also is, now how does the exact words fit into the context of the story, right? And so this was an opportunity for them to write their narrative and to stand in their truth and to be able to have their words honored the way that they anticipated them being honored. And so I use narrative inquiry approaches in my dissertation, because I did want to tell the story, but I wanted the Black men's voices to really be what was the driving force behind the story, right? And so it was really important to me. And you're right, as you look through, there are a lot of spaces where I'm like, okay, insert story here, right? And this is how it situates and fits into the context of the global picture. I also said this is just one piece of the puzzle. So even all 10 stories, right, it's just a small piece to what it means to be a Black man who teaches.
This is a little bit forward. This is on bottom of 105, or top, sorry, top of 105. You write, man, every time I read a book, report, anything, and the word context is used, never fails. I always get something to share. So he writes, the context for this discussion was that Moses shared there is a perception as a Black male teacher that you are from an urban environment. You had struggles. You had multiple kids out of wedlock. You are sexually and intimately irresponsible, i.e. rapist. And you do not know how to speak or articulate correctly. Additionally, Moses told me that it is those perceptions and beliefs that he has to fight through, whereas a white man or woman, it is a clear slate. They do not have the obstacles or challenges that black men have. Moses told me this situation tends to happen to black men a lot, which can lead to constant battles that are exhausting. He said racial battle fatigue. He continued, and when you have to do it amongst your own profession, amongst your own peers at times, I do notice there can be a sense of withdrawal, to be quiet, to be invisible. Ralph Ellison smiles. Because the constant fighting can be overwhelming. Tell me about it. Man, all of this, you are assumed rapist. You are assumed to be ignorant, unintelligent, irresponsible. You grew up with crack, or you grew up selling and smoking crack. When I hear all of this, I'm reminded there are less than 2% of the teachers in this part of the world are black males. The overwhelming majority of the white people that we're talking about, it is not the man, it's the woman, white women, who think you are an inarticulate, thug, drug-peddling rapist. That's what they think about Jamal at 12, and that's what they think about you at 42. That right there, because when we talk about racism, it's patriarchy. It's the man. And I have said for 14 years, you cannot have a system of white supremacy racism without the woman. This right here is telling me a whole lot about what it means to be a white woman, because it would be, or I put it in the form of a question, am I ignorant? Because I've been saying, we talk about the school to prison pipeline or the bottleneck for black teachers. Isn't that white women are principally to blame for both?
I think it's a lot of factors, right? And when we look at the population who teaches, right? I think that is very telling of what it means to be a teacher in K through 12 and what it means to look like me as a teacher in K through 12 right now. And it is exhausting, right? And so when you think about all of the things that we just talked about, why would I want to step into a space that looks and feels like that for people who look like me, right? It doesn't make sense, right? And so I'm always like, make it make sense, right? If I have all this backstory of what it's like for people who look like me to be teachers, why would I sign up for that and then sign up for $38,000 a year, right, on top of all that? It's exhausting. And so that also, right, is what creates obstacles and challenges, especially for black men who are even considering going into the teaching profession, right? I'm going to have to put up with all this stuff, and I actually still have to do my job, which is teaching, right, which is what I thought I was hired to do. No thank you, right? And for those of us who don't know that we have all of this that we need to kind of battle through, when we get there, it's like, oh, I could be doing something else, making a lot more money too, right? So I'm out of here. I'm going to go ahead and head out because this is too much and it's not what I signed up for. And on top of it not being what I signed up for, I also don't feel like I can voice my concerns. I don't have support. So I am feeling lonely and I'm just figuring it out.
For sure. For sure. I'll pitch my question again, and unless I've looked at the numbers incorrectly, white women make up about 60, 70% approximately
of the teachers this part of the world. We're talking K through 12, even a healthy chunk of the students and faculty. Once you move on to college, university level, once you're doing your prep to be a teacher. So again, wouldn't it have to be that a major part of the white supremacy obstacles that will be in place for non-white teachers, black males in particular, white women?
I don't know if I would say a major part. I think they play a role. However, we also then need to look at, it's not just the teachers, right? Because the teachers, all teachers, are they have guidelines and things too, right? So, yes, the direct kind of like teacher-to-student experience, absolutely. And we then look at what does the school leaders look like? And then what does administration look like? Who makes major decisions that impact students, especially students of color, in school districts, right? Those are not only white women. And so I think that's important too, because you do get these policies, these procedures, these ways of doing, these kind of like ultimatums in a lot of cases, where it's like you do this or you don't, and if you don't, here are all these consequences, right? So I think pulling back a little bit to look at the global picture is also important of who are the key players that sit in all of these roles and how do these roles influence and impact ultimately students.
Wow. Wow. Well, there for sure are many white men and white women who are responsible, but I was reminded when they do all that sexism talk and all the rest of it. Aya Gruber, she was a guest on our program beginning of the year. We talked about her book, The Role of White Feminism in Mass Incarceration. And, oh, my goodness. So, in fact, the title of her book is The Feminist War on Crime, The Unexpected Role of White Women's Liberation in Mass Incarceration. That's the title. I inserted the white, but I mean, hey, that's being accurate. We had a very interesting conversation about even that word unexpected right there with ignorant, unaware, willful ignorance, all of that. But that was right at the beginning of the year when we talked about all of that, where white women again, black males ended up in Carolyn Bryant Donham. White women again, right there at the center of this. And I said for 14 years, the way we talk about this is patriarchy, the man. I said for years, we really underestimate. That is so flagrant when these sort of perceptions about what we think of Jamal, Tamir Rice, what we think of black male teachers. Before we let you enjoy the rest of your Monday evening, you used the term standing in your blackness, or standing in my blackness, in the classroom, being your authentic self. It's in your dissertation as well. When you say blackness, what does that mean?
For me, it means bringing all of who I am as a black person and what that means for me. One quick example is not feeling like I have to code switch, right? So I have a PhD in English. I understand all of the rules and how it works. And what I'm not going to do is discredit or devalue my native language, which is African American English, right? And so, sure, standard English, academic English, all the like is important in certain situations. And that's not my native tongue, and that's not what I honor or value most. So showing up in spaces where I don't feel like I need to code switch, I can show up as exactly who I am with my dialect, my variety, and be okay with that. Two, not feeling like I do have to show up as someone else. Oftentimes at the beginning of the semester, I send out a welcome message to all my students before the class meets, and I almost always get a handful of students who are like, "We thought you were white." And I'm like, based on how I write, right? And so that's an aha and a noticing for them, but also for me, right? I'm like, that tells me not necessarily who you are, but in society, that tells me that you don't expect people who look like me to show up and to be able to write a sentence, right? It wasn't anything pretty or extreme about the welcome message. It was like, hey, I'm going to see y'all next week, right? So being able to really be who I am and not feel like, one, I have to dim my light, but two, not feeling like whatever space I walk in, I have to be someone else, because that's also exhausting and not for me. So the same person that you got tonight, the same person that my family gets, is the same person that my profession and my work gets as well. I'm like, I can't be two or three or four different people. You get one person, right? And so for me, that's what standing in my blackness means, not having to mold or shape myself based on someone else's expectation of how I should show up.
Love it. Love it. Love it. Thank you for the detailed response, sir. I will end the way we started. To Mary A. Lomax, the woman who raised me, I love you so much. Accomplishing this degree was for you, Ma. To all the black male teachers who are dedicated to the profession and continue to persist despite the challenges you are up against, this is also for you. We have been talking about his 2021 dissertation, When They See Us, Narratives of Black Male Teachers. He is the chair and associate professor of academic literacies at Anne Arundel Community College. Much obliged for your time and insight. Wow. Looking, you will have to do like futures, maybe a book follow-up where we can get that chapter on the sexual harassment, but you will have an eager audience waiting to read your future brilliant scholarship on this subject matter. Really great work. I'm super glad we could have you on the program. Hope it was worthy of your time and energy this evening, sir.
Absolutely, absolutely. It was my absolute pleasure. If you need anything, please don't hesitate to reach out.
Much obliged. Keep up the outstanding work. Really glad I got to read your dissertation. Like I said, if they knew what I was doing, they would have barred me from the library. Man, keep it up, Dr. Tomlin. We'll be looking forward to the book. In fact, the books, you hear, test books coming. I guess we'll get those first, and then we'll look for future work as well. But keep up your outstanding work, and we will definitely be in contact, Dr. Tomlin.
All right, perfect. Thank you so much.
Be well, sir. Dr. Antione D. Tomlin, child of Mary A. Lomax, chatting it up about his dissertation. Now, see, this is another one. I'm not sure. I went to the University of Washington, forgot that I even got this. It had to, thank God my memory is not that bad, where I remember, like, oh yeah, I did get that report. Let's follow up on that. But if I had not directly gone to the University of Washington Library, I wonder, could I have gotten this report? Is this one that you could just, boop, go online and, oh yes, lack of black male teachers. Let's read this dissertation. This is another one where I say, man, white people are so informed. Generally speaking, white people have much easier access to the, matter of fact, so that's three in a row. Our guest, Dr. Hui Bai, he was on the program last Monday, week from today, last Monday. We white genetic for 2 hours, talked to a doctor, Stanford University. That's all he does, research white genetic annihilation and people classified as white, their response to reports about their dwindling population numbers. That was Monday, right? His published reports. That was one where I said, ooh, I'm not sure you'd have access to these if you can't get on that campus or university access, whatever. We had Dr. Berkeley Franz on the program on Wednesday, right? We talked about her work on COVID-19, white supremacy, racism, which also included white genetic annihilation within all of that. That was another one where I said, dang, I don't know if you'd be able to get access to these reports. You can't get on campus, what have you. Same thing today. Now, it might be, I have to look again, but I know a lot of Dr. Friends' publications, and as well with Dr. Bai, a lot of the material was not available until, bang, you get on campus, and then unless you're a student faculty, you can access offline. But if you're just some nobody bum like old Gus T, no, you have to be on campus or what have you to get access. That also
in my, there's an enormous gulf. We talked about that today. There's an enormous gulf in terms of information between non-white people and white people, which is also very deliberate. Roger Galupsi in Kansas, we talked about Brown v. Board of Education, Topeka, Kansas. Roger Galupsi in Kansas City, Kansas. They said, why are you so attracted to black females? His black wife asked him, and what did he say? Because you all are uneducated. That's one of the most important stories of this year. Roger Galupsi, easy. And that's ongoing. You have to follow that all the way into next year because that's a trial, a testimony, transcript. Oh my, we get more details. But whew, that was in the newspaper report from this year. His black wife asked him, why are you so attracted to black females? They're uneducated. It's a reason for that. Brown v. Board of Education. It's a reason for that. We did the program. They closed their schools. Virginia, Coon Man, closed the schools for 5 years as opposed to allowing black people to go to school. I'm saying that they wouldn't allow me into the library for years. They didn't allow black people into many public libraries across this part of the country and across the world. Information. Very important. That's another one to think about. Who is more informed about white supremacy, racism? I can't emphasize enough. I think the scholarship that we heard from Dr. Tomlin, amazing. I'm so glad. I mean, literally, I did not go to the library to look for this at all. I had so many other things that I was looking for. I think this is on one of those days. I can even give you the exact date when I got this report, but I think this is on one of those days where I had many, many things to research. And I just said, I'll take a few moments to see what I can find. I don't even remember if I used Black Miss Andrea. I may have, but whatever my little black male, you know, privilege term was, I should do that too to see what pops up for black male privilege. But this popped up in the search engine. I said, oh, wow. And this, hey, you're on campus. You can just take anything that you find, reports, books, everything. I mean, everything. You just be greedy. That's why I said I forgot about it. I took so many things I didn't even remember. Like, oh yeah, he had that report on the lack of black male teachers. Like, that's so important, young academic and all the rest of it. Bang, glad we were able to make that one happen. And we're here every day. I don't know about 12 days of Christmas, but man, we are closing out a Hall of Fame year, Hall of Fame style, here tomorrow. My three tag words were chocolate, white supremacy, racism, child rape. That's tomorrow. We're here Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, every day. Same time, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. Context of white supremacy. I'll see if folks who dialed in, if they have commentary they would like to share. I can't emphasize enough, man. Dr. Curry's work, The Man Knot. That's how I learned about Black Misandry. That's how I learned about Delectable Negro. That's how I learned about Thomas A. Foster, Rethinking Rufus. Black male slaves being raped. The concept, Black Misandry. All of that right there. Dr. Curry's work, so critically important. And I submit just that concept, Black Misandry. That would have substantially added to the value of Dr. Tomlin's report. I'd be so excited once he reads that book to see, you know, if he's excited about it as I am, and to see how he applies that to his thinking and research, Black Misandry, and really capturing the totality of how the system of white supremacy operates and focuses so much of the violence and terrorism on black males, non-white people in general. But Dr. Welsing, black males, white genetic annihilation, darker they are, the more of a threat they represent. And that's exactly in the dissertation. We think of you all as no count children, baby making rapists, and then sexually harassing you all the, now really put that together. We already think of you as a rapist. Everybody, other male staff, female staff, hey, even students can come and sexually exploit.
who's going to believe a white man was flirting with me? He sexually harassed me. A white woman, she was flirting with me. She sexually harassed me, sabotaging my career because I won't date her. White student, non-white student, she, he, they are flirting with me, sexually harassing me, threatening to lie on me if I don't go along with it. Any of those scenarios, who is going to believe a black man? Me, retired firefighter, young academic, Dr. Tomlin, you line them up, President Obama. What black male is going to be believed when they step forward saying that any of those individuals, they sexually harass? It's going to be the same thing that I told you we heard on neutralizing workplace racism when this was brought up in a serious environment, workplace training about what is inappropriate conduct. The response was, hey, we can't be flirting with males and all that sort of thing. That's inappropriate, too. The response was, he said, they didn't even say black male. They just said males in general. They didn't say, hey, you can't be flirting and making comments to Al Sharpton, Tiger Woods. That's not what they said. Herman Cain, Justice Thomas. That's not what they said. Or Renthal James. They just said, you can't flirt with anybody. This goes for males. It was just real general. Laughter and snickering so bad they had to call folks back. And say, hey, this is for real, as the young folks used to say. With black male privilege. That was birthed, by the way, by some of the same folks, same scholarship, intersectionality, and all of that nonsense. Nonsense. Can't say white supremacy racism. System of white supremacy racism. Can't say black misandry either. Folks who dialed in with us have commentary to say. Excellent commentary there we heard from Dr. Antoine D. Tomlin, victim of white supremacy racism. Folks that are with us have commentary or just listening?
Hello, Gus.
Irie in Louisiana.
So I have a question for you. Have you read Mr. Bell's critical race theory? And if so, do you find it to be true that all the other books that have come out subsequently are basically misinterpreting or reinterpreting his synopsis, which I haven't read it, but I've heard some excerpts of, and it, there are parts that remind me of the compensatory code, actually. And it sounds like people, particularly Kimberly Crenshaw, are redistributing it in a manner to fit the intersectionality stuff that's been coming out. Do you have the same purview?
I'm certainly not an expert on Derek Bell's work. I have read some of his work before. We've talked about some of his work on the program before, and even this concept has come up before in terms of critical race theory and what that is. I do not know what that is. I have read portions of it. I've heard folks talk about it before. That is not the framework that I use. I'm not saying that it does or doesn't have constructive merit. I'm just saying that that's not the framework that I use to discuss racism, white supremacy. What I see is that frequently the concept of intersectionality, it is frequently people who use this concept, especially scholars, when they write, that they will reference
Derek Bell's work. And I mean, that happens in scholarship where you see the influence. I've seen people where they start off, they're quoting Mr. Fuller, and then they end up saying showcase blacks. Mr. Fuller doesn't say that, but they're saying it and even saying that they were influenced by Mr. Fuller. They may be influenced by Derek Bell, and then they build from that and go to all of the intersectionality, and that's how we end up with black male privilege and all of that. That's why I don't even use the framework. It is none of that is system of white supremacy racism. That is the most accurate term I've concluded as to what we're talking about. That's why they push to all these other concepts: diversity, inclusion, equity, bias, prejudice, race, racialism, and more terms coming, as opposed to, and even systemic racism. They got tons of ways of moving it to everything but system of white supremacy racism throughout the known universe. Individuals classified as white, that's what that means. That is making it plain. We talked about it that direct just last week, days ago. It hadn't even been a full calendar week. Dr. Berkeley Franz, a white woman, again, her research on COVID-19 and racism, but right in the middle of that was white genetic annihilation, which gets at the very core. What does it mean to be white, and why I got to see black males as rapists? But yeah, I'm not an expert on Derek Bell, but I do see many of the folks that use the term intersectionality in quotes. Yes, they will quote Derek Bell and reference, revere his work and scholarship and how that influenced their thinking. But yeah, I'm not an expert on his work. And yeah, system of white supremacy, I think, would be the best term. Hope that answers the question.
Other yeah, folks? It does. Oh, okay. My phone's going to die. Thank you. Good night.
Yes, ma'am. I'm in Louisiana. Any other commentary, questions folks need to get in?
Yes, I just thought of a question that I'm not sure on the answer to. Even when school systems, public school systems were separated, where you would have all non-white black, did females were the majority, black females were the majority in teachers at that time? I'm not sure. That's why I'm asking.
Yes, that was the case even then. And in fact, it's either right. In Dr. Curry's book, The Man Not, and or in some of the other articles that he's written about, the disparity in terms of the number of people getting degrees so that they would even be able to get that job to teach has been so wildly disproportionate that black females get way more college degrees and all of that than black males, that this is not something new. This has been the case for a long time. This imbalance in the classroom and just all of the same things that we talk about. This is not something new. This is, in fact, he says, Dr. W.E.B. Du Bois was writing about this 100 years ago, this imbalance. So this has been the case for a long time. This has been how white people have ran the plantation for a long time.
Right, because that was my early educational experience. And I also went to college to be a teacher, but it was in physical education was what was to be my subject once I came out of college. And that's where, from my experiences, the majority of black males were. There was a few that was in, you know, the reading, writing, arithmetic, but for the most part, the black males that I recall were coaches and physical education teachers, which could be two different things in some cases.
That is very similar to my experience, and I don't think we are the exact same age at all, but that's what I'm saying. It's been the same. This problem has been pretty consistent for a very, very long time, but that is exactly my experience. I'm thinking offhand, I had one black male teacher, like K through 12,
I think I can remember one, maybe two, and one of them, what he just said, physical education, and I remember one all the way through. One black male. I remember other black female teachers that I had all sprinkled throughout. Certainly the majority were white women, but I remember one black male teacher the entire time. And even, I think even once you get to the college level, I think it would only go up. I would get to add two. Oh, three. Get to add three in from the collegiate level. But yeah, but that's been the case for, and it gets even worse, generally speaking, at the college level. Like, that's years of all of that school to prison pipeline and Ritalin and remedial classes and all the rest of it, suspensions and expulsions. Like, by the time you get, you know, there, it's, they've whittled it way, way down. So, and as he's those standardized tests and all the rest of it. So, you know, yeah, black male privilege.
Yeah, for me, college, it was a little bit more of black males in undergrad and grad school especially. Most of the teachers in graduate school were black males. Undergrad, it was a few more, primarily because of my major was physical education, and they taught some of the classes, kinesiology, which is probably the toughest class in physical education, but there were a little bit more black males, and primarily because I went to two historical black colleges. That's probably has something to do with it also.
Everyone satisfied? Last 30 seconds. See if anybody, anything else to share? We'll assume folks are good. Again, we should be here tomorrow, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. Chocolate, white supremacy, child rape. Chatted it up, Dr. Antoine D. Tomlin, this evening, his great dissertation. Checking again, I'm gonna have to look and see. Now, could you all access that report if you are not on a campus or what have you with access? I'll have to see. Hope it was worthy of your Monday evening. Stay safe out there for the holiday. Again, they'll have those sobriety checkpoints, so be mindful. Sobriety would be best. If you're going, doing the celebrations and hanging out with the relatives and all that, sober. If you got a party and all that, be someplace where you can spend the night. Leave the next morning when you are sober, ready to roll. Creator, we ask that you help us remain patient with other black people, victims of white supremacy. We ask that you help us remain patient with ourselves. Remind us to demonstrate the highest levels of black self-respect at all times, in all places, each and every time we are in contact with another black person. It has been time. Replace white supremacy with justice immediately. Cow signing out. Thanks all for tuning in.
Nigga, you so brainwashed.
I'm a victim,
your
brother.
Problem. You're a victim.
I'm a victim of 400 years of conditioning.
Shut up.
The man has programmed my conditioning. Mm-hmm. Even my conditioning has been conditioned.